Welcome. It's August 23rd, 2019 from the Troy Lee Design Saloon here in Corona, California. It's the Whiskey Throttle Show. Thanks for tuning in, everybody. We've got a cool guest today, former national motocross champion, two-time West Coast supercross champion, a member of three winning motocross the nations team for the USA, Ivan Tedesco. Hot Sauce is here with us. Good guy. Really fun dude. We've both kind of spent a lot of time around him, just hanging out at whether it's Seller's House back east or here locally. So should be fun chatting with him.
Plus, he's the only guy that's retired that's gotten skinnier. So he's making us retired guys look bad. So I said to him, I'm like, dude, you look like a lean, mean racing machine over there. But he says he's doing a lot of testing. So he's, we'll hear about that.
He's 125 weight ready.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, he's ready for the dream races. My co-host GL, as always.
Good to see you.
Yeah, welcome back, man.
Good to be here.
And we've got DJ Donnie over here on our producing booth. Donnie, welcome.
Good morning. Welcome, how are you guys welcome, doing? Welcome.
Doing good, man. Ready to rip this thing. I want to thank our sponsors, PowerDot. Check out PowerDot.com. If you're not familiar with them, you can get 20% off using the code WhiskeyThrottle on that product. Method Race Wheels, they're bringing you the front-end chatter segment. Decal Works bringing you our last call. Four Wheel Parts bringing you the Get At Me Q&A. We got our Troy Lee Designs timeout today. We're going to get a little break mid-show.
Oh, it's a timeout now?
Now it's a timeout. Adidas.
Am I in timeout?
You might be. Mostly that's just at our live shows. You'll be all right today.
We're at Coffee Throttle.
It's Coffee Throttle this morning. Big thank you to Pro Circuit, Dunlop Tires, and Hilo Concepts. They're giving you 20% off as well. Discount code if you buy anything over there.
Which is also Whiskey Throttle.
Yep. Specialized. Check out their new Demo 29. Really cool new bicycle they've got out. Along with the Levo and the Knievo. Awesome bikes. Big thanks to Racer X as well. If you do not subscribe, get over there. 3 months of digital and print for 99 cents. It's a no-brainer. So let's jump into our front-end chatter here from Method Race Wheels. Method's bringing you the toughest, fastest, lightest wheels in off-road racing. So whether you have a truck, a sprinter, a van, a UTV, a lot of folks are getting into UTV racing these days, and they make the best wheels for those. Not only is it make your rig look sweet, they actually serve a function. They're strong. They have a patented bead grip technology to keep the wheel from popping off the bead. So if you're doing any legit off-roading, there's not really another wheel that's even close. A couple things we want to talk about today. Tomac and Gasher both wrapped up titles.
Gasher?
Geisher?
Geisa.
Geisa?
It's like a Giza Geisa.
Geisa. It's spelled like he just, you know, grabbed a bunch of letters out of the alphabet and threw them together, so... My apologies.
Well, he is Slovenian, so it makes sense.
Yeah, my Slovenians are way off.
Well, I think for Geisa, anyone that follows the GP probably was not surprised that he wrapped it up. But I think the thing that probably sucks for him a little bit is people don't give him quite as much credit maybe he deserves, because everyone's thing is, oh, well, Cairoli wasn't there, Hurlings isn't there. And I've always said at the end of the day, that's not his fault. You know, he was there. You got to be in it to win it. But... You sort of get that feeling that people are delegitimizing that title, but it's his third one. I mean, that puts you in a special category, and I think that was cool. But on the flip side, Tomac three in a row, and nice bounce back from Unadilla. It was funny, we're talking the TV compound, we're kind of guessing what kind of weekend it was going to be, and I'm like, I have a feeling he's going to just go out and win and do this in style. And yeah, he bounced back. Great race. There was definitely had his hands full with Roxon at times, and you know, a few other guys going pretty fast. Even Anderson with some good late speed, Marvin. But Tomac was just too strong once again all year long. You know, at times he did have a couple odd random off days, but he minimized the damage.
Yeah, and got that title. You know, he takes a lot of heat, and it is odd. We've talked about this before. When he's off, he is. He's noticeably off.
To me, he seems like, I try to say, it's like the pendulum swinging. Like, I felt like I was pretty good and not as good as times. Tomac's like incredibly good, and then like, what the hell just happened? Incredibly good? Yeah. What the hell just happened?
Do you feel like this year he dialed it back, or do you think the competition was more stiff?
I think so. I think two things. I think both of those. I think the competition has kind of elevated a little bit because they're all after him. So I think, you know, in the past, you often saw one, two, maybe three guys that could win. This year, I think on speed, there was potentially on certain days, seven, eight guys that had the speed to win and the endurance and all the other things. because you look at all those guys, they've all got titles behind them somewhere along the line. And I think with Tomac, because we talked about this even a little bit during the practice shows that they do on the NBC Gold, you know, a little bit behind the scenes, but it's like, and I think Weigand even mentioned it, he goes, you know, people were critical that he would have to win by a minute and a half, and now that he's toned it back, they're critical as well. Like, what do you think? And I said, no, it's true. You can't win nowadays with fans because you're damned if you do and you're damned if you don't. I think for Tomac, he's had to try and teach himself to just not, when it's not feeling it, just not to throw it away and self-destruct. And by doing that, he's taken some heat. But, you know, at the end of the day, he scored a lot more points than anyone else, and that's why he won the championship.
I'm sure that fat check will subsidize some of that heat he's receiving.
Yeah, three in a row puts him into really rare air, too. There's only a handful of guys that have won three titles in a row. RVs.
Well, if you look in the premier class, it was the fourth time it was done. First was Gary Jones, then Tony DeStefano, Carmichael, and now Tomac. So that's a pretty small group there.
Yeah. Pretty impressive. And he does, like you said, and I think Stewart was a lot this way. He was so expected to win that even a second or a third was like, oh, what happened?
Yeah, what happened to him today?
Why didn't it's like,
man, you suck. You got second.
He got a second, you know.
What's his problem?
And I think Eli had thrown away enough titles from crashing and pushing too hard that he's like, okay.
I think what it is with Eli, if he's just not feeling it, you can see it sometimes. He just can't get into that rhythm. And I think before he tried to fight through that, and that's when it went sideways. This year, I think he just licked his wounds and took what he could.
For me, it looked like the smartest year he's ever ridden.
Well, that's the thing.
I agree.
It was the most calculated.
It's another title.
Yeah, I think I'm like, oh, this is great. He's like doing what he needs to do to win, and he's not trying to win by a minute and a half. Yeah.
Hey, don't worry. I made myself look like an idiot on the show because I'm talking about the points. I'm like, that's the 50 points he needs. And the producer's like, it's 49. Son of a bitch!
In your ear, you're like, shit.
Yeah, I'm hitting the mute button going, damn it. And then I think Roxon lost another spot, and I'm like, told you it was 50 points.
That's funny. Hey, while I'm drinking some coffee here, this is Fire Department Coffee. I want to mention them, big supporter of our show. This is their light roast. They've got all kinds of different blends and flavors, so check those guys out. They're giving you 20% off using the code WhiskeyThrottle. They also, on top of that 20%, are giving another 10% to firefighter charities to help injured firefighters. So firedeptcoffee.com. Check those guys out.
Ping, you really look like you need that coffee this morning.
I'm dragging a little bit this morning.
Yeah, a little bit.
You look like you came from a big rage.
Fun night?
Yeah. I'm in the middle of a vacation, so it's
all right.
I'm entitled.
You are entitled.
Must be nice.
Yeah.
Us working class folks are back to work.
Yeah, well, yeah. Shane McElrath, that's the other guy I want to talk about. TLD is Shane McElrath. This guy has had a pretty rough year. They've been struggling a little bit all year with handling setup. He's just not felt right. They went back and played with other frames. They've done all this stuff. It's just been a tough year for him. And I don't know what happened. I don't think he even knows what happened, but holy crap, 1-1 for the overall, his first win of the year, and he just did it in convincing style.
I don't think he's even been close to the podium.
Not even close.
I don't even know if he's even seen it at the first 10 rounds. And then all of a sudden on the weekend, it was really impressive. And then, you know, first moto was impressive, but then you always go, can he back it up?
Yeah.
And, well, yeah.
It's just like, yeah, sure did.
I'm like, there's probably a lot of people that do those fantasy leagues going, oh, yeah. Where did this come from?
Dude, it literally looked like he just decided I'm going to win today. That's
literally what it
looked like.
He looked so in control doing it.
Yeah,
he looked casual. It looked.
He passed for the wins. I mean, he was passing guys.
Yeah, it was an impressive win.
It wasn't like he just got handed it to him. He earned those.
There wasn't a first turn pileup, and he rode. He was fast.
But you know, it's so weird though. And Ping, you must have had this, but where there's just days where things just click, and people are like, "How are you going so fast?" And you're like, I don't even know. I don't have an explanation. It just came easy that day. And then there's other days you ride your tail off and they're like, nice top 10, bro. And you're like,
you know,
I don't get it.
There was something, and I'm going to preface this by saying this is something Ryan Hughes talks a lot about. So grab a fistful of salt, take it with a bunch of grains of it. But he talks about when it comes to performance is focusing on the result or focusing on just like what you're doing and being in the moment. And I think that that's what happens when guys have those days. It's like you're not even worried about the result. You're just in it. You're like so focused on what's on the moment. Everything just starts to flow. And I've had those days, and it's like, God, why can't I do that every day?
I know.
Because those other days, you're kind of you're hung up with just other stuff in your mind. Like, okay, I got if I get this position, I'll get this overall. It's like
strange. It is funny sport, man.
It's so mental and so hard to get the mental side right.
But it can happen
right.
in any sport. I mean, you know, sometimes I refer to NFL. Obviously, I know it's a big sport in this country. But these weekends, it's like the number one ranked team in the league plays. And everyone's like, oh, this is going to be a blowout. And all of a sudden, the other team came in with an attitude of nothing to lose, aired the ball out, took some big risks, had some trick plays, and all of a sudden was a huge upset. It happens in sport.
How much is it for a rider like, and I know not just the track, but actually going to the track going, I love this place, or I've had good results here in the future.
It definitely helps.
That lightens the load on your brain.
Yeah. No, I think it definitely helps because I remember there were certain tracks that I just knew when I went there, I'm like, this is the place that I do well at. And you try not to let it affect you. You try to go to the places you're not as happy and go, I'm going to do well this year. But deep in your back of your mind, you're like, I freaking hate this place.
I know you're not. You hate this place.
Sucks, this is bad. But you try and convince yourself at least.
It doesn't always work either because I loved Millville. I loved going to Millville. Like just cool people, cool location. And I sucked there every year. I couldn't get out of my own way at that place.
The whoop monster got you?
Every week, every time.
Yeah.
Every year. All right, anything else you want to talk about in our Method Race Wheels front-end chatter?
No, I think we nailed it.
All right, we nailed it. So I think at this point, then, let's just jump right into our featured guest. Our featured guest today is brought to you by PowerDot. Again, go over to PowerDot.com and check them out. You can get the single or the duo units for 20% off using the code WhiskeyThrottle. And talk to anyone that knows what the hell they're talking about. They'll tell you those things are awesome. So let's get Ivan Tedesco on up here. This guy... it's funny. Like I got a question here. I was at his very first professional race, and then we got to be buddies, just hanging out and riding over the years. We were kind of all running in the same circles. So, in fact, we got some fun stories we'll get to about your championship party back at Sellers' house. Hot sauce was there.
That was a good time.
How are you, man?
I'm good.
Thanks for coming on.
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah, good to see you. GL was saying before the show, you look like you're down to fighting weight, man. Look at you.
Yeah, the PC boys have been putting me to work, doing a lot of testing and. I'm training Garrett Marchbank, so been riding the bicycle a lot, riding a little bit, try to stay in shape, I guess.
Are you going out with him and, like, actually training with him?
Yeah. I mean, on the bicycle, I don't do the gym work. I got my old trainer, Darren Stockton, helping me on that end, so he works with him on the off-the-bike training. But, like, on the bicycle, I'm riding a lot with him, you know, so, yeah, I'm out there quite a bit for how old I am, I guess.
How's your speed with him?
I don't know. Certain days I'm okay, but, man, he's fast. Yeah. I mean, especially during the week, that kid can bring some heat and definitely kicks my ass.
He's being modest. I saw him at Glen Helen. He still goes pretty darn good. It's just these kids are so fast, like you said.
They really are.
Every year, I think the sport just gets elevated slightly.
You know, the hardest part about getting old and keep going to the track is I'm okay if Garrett Marchbanks goes by me or, like, one of these young pros. I'm like, all right, you know, this guy's good. But some dude will go by you and you've never heard of the name. You're like, and they just like.
Yeah, and then you try to grab some extra and then you almost crash and you're like, all right, dude. You gotta check the ego for a second, right?
Some vet intermediate guy.
Yeah. I'd never even seen most of the people that pass me these days. But anyway. Ivan, I'll tell you, I think you had one of the most quietly successful careers of anyone in this sport. You're just kind of like low key, you don't make a bunch of noise about your stuff, but. Yeah. You won a lot of stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I had a successful career. If you had asked me when I was 12 years old and said, here, this is what you're going to do. Because I wasn't one of those guys, you know, amateur where I was the best. You know, I was a good rider. I was top five amateur. You know, I won some motos and never won Loretto's. But I was always a pretty good supercross rider, naturally. I think that helped me.
Okay.
And, you know, a lot of these kids, they struggle in supercross and your confidence gets kicked down. And then by the time outdoors comes around... You know, you're kind of a mess. But for me, Supercross was kind of always natural for me, and it was more the outdoors that I had to learn how to do.
Yeah, and I got a question about that too, but we'll get there. Tell us about your hometown. You grew up in New Mexico.
Yeah.
Albuquerque?
Albuquerque. I grew up on the west side of Albuquerque, and it's kind of ghetto where I grew up. And yeah, it's cool. I mean, I moved away from there when I was about 17, so I haven't been there for a while, but Yeah, it was a good way to grow up for sure.
But that's what got you going. What was your first bike? Was it your dad or who got you into it?
It was actually my brother. My family had nothing to do with moto. My brother, since he's a year and a half older than me, Gio, and since he was a little kid, he just loved dirt bikes, you know, just magazines, whatever. And they bought him a YZ80 at the time, and they brought it home. I started crying because I wanted one just because he got one. I wasn't even into it, but they bought me one of those big wheel 80s with the fat balloon tires.
Yeah.
So that was my first bike, and we actually went to a race, I think, that first weekend, you know, just a local race, and I raced that thing, and I had to get something different. I was like, so they got me a KX60 at that
balloon
point.
Tires,
yeah, yeah. Mud. But that's how it started. My brother was into it. That's how it started. You know,
went to the beach a lot. He was hanging out at the beach.
That bike's awesome.
Yeah, the beach at Albuquerque.
Good, for sure.
They got good beaches there.
So were you, I've always got this theory, and GL blows it out of the water, but like the younger brothers end up always being more successful in racing. Not always. I can't say always because the Stewart brothers throw that off and a few others, Alessis. But
yeah,
I think for a lot of guys, you grow up constantly chasing your brother and wanting to do what he's doing and, you know, be with the guys he's with, you know what I mean? It makes you grow up faster and progress a little bit quicker.
Well, I think you also see what they do that worked and then the mistakes, the failures. So it just helps you kind of with a little bit of guidance as well.
For sure. I mean, my brother, he was a good rider. He was always better than I was. He was real smooth, real calculated. I was kind of more the out of control, just crasher kid, you know, I'd go for it. But I mean, he raced supercross and he got some top tens in West Coast and did pretty well, but then he had a bad head injury at Anaheim 1 year and was in a coma for like 5 days. It was a pretty heavy deal.
Oh, really?
You know, and when he got out of the coma, he had to kind of relearn. Where he hit his brain was on the speech part of his brain, so he had to relearn how to talk, you know, like he knew what he would want to say, but just random words would come out. You know, so he had a rough couple years there where he had to relearn how to do some stuff, and he tried to race after that, but he was just never the same. And shame, because he was a great rider, you know.
Yeah.
He was always...
You guys were up for Plano at the same time, didn't you?
Yeah, we did. That was actually after his head injury. You know,
it was?
Yeah, and he raced, but he I think he was still a little scared, which is understandable.
Yeah.
And
that scare you at all?
For sure, because I was signed with Plano Honda, but I had a broken wrist at the time. I was at Anaheim. I was in the autograph line signing autographs, and someone came and told me, hey, your brother got hurt. I didn't think nothing. Okay, maybe broke his arm or something. Then they're like, no, he really got hurt. You need to go to the hospital. And yeah, it was a heavy deal for sure. It made me second guess, like, hey, do I really want to do this? Because that was right when I was starting my professional career. And but you know, I pushed it aside and, you know, made it happen, I guess.
That's crazy. Did it change his personality?
Yeah, a little bit, you know, especially at first. But you know, as the years came by, he kind of came back to normal. And yeah, he's somewhat normal now.
And you guys are pretty close still, huh?
Yeah, we're close. He's still in Albuquerque.
Oh, is he?
Yeah.
It was the first time I'd seen him. We went to, where the hell we go? Oh, Farley Castle.
Yeah, he was with me last year.
And Gio was there wrenching for Ivan or helping.
That's
whatever.
That's cool. Yeah, I brought him over to the vet destinations with me.
Yeah, that was cool to see him.
You mentioned growing up, obviously, in New Mexico. And it seemed like for a while, like I remember when I first came over, it was the Plano team. But it seemed like there was quite a few guys from that New Mexico area. Tell us some of the guys you rode with growing up.
Or yeah, I was one of the younger guys. There was Ryan Clark, Isaiah Johnson, Keith Johnson, and Kevin Johnson, a bunch of Johnsons, and then Justin Buckaloo, which
that's
I mean,
right.
He was,
I was trying to remember where he was.
We were like the same age, and he was like my local rival. But even across the net, he was the best in the nation. You know, he was the guy.
He was so fast on super minis.
He really
and
was. And I always had that, you know, at my local track, so I had the best in the nation to kind of, you know, that was like the target.
It's funny to say that now. You know, who would have thought that at one point that was like a hot spot?
No, for sure. And I mean, there was probably five or six of us that were racing supercross at the same time. And, you know, but I think what helped me kind of separate from that group and go on and have a little more success was I moved out here and kind of said, you know, I'm going to do this. And
yeah.
A lot of them stayed in New Mexico. And, you know, I think that's what helped me.
You got to go. You kind of got to go where the sport is, right?
Yeah. And for me, like at the time, I had no money. I was basically living out of my truck, you know, and it was my only option. I had to make it happen. And I think there's something to be said about that too. Mm-hmm. Like if you have to make something happen, you know.
Yeah.
This I've seen it in the sport. It doesn't matter what country they grew up in. Kids that had to hustle or didn't have much seemed to work a little bit harder. Like a lot of these kids that have the talent, and dad threw everything at them, and you look at them and you're like, they're actually spoiled. Yep. I just feel like when it gets a little tough, like when you get to that top peak, which is turning pro, and like you said, you get your confidence beat down, a lot of them seem to kind of fizzle out. Yeah. It was the kind of grinders and the guys that had it a little tougher that sort of come through.
It's interesting. It's actually that strategy has been used in battle over the years. I don't know if you know the story of Cortez, the explorer. When they landed in Mexico to conquer Mexico, he ordered his crew to burn all their ships.
Yeah.
And he said, we're going to conquer this land, and this is where we're going to live. Like, we're taking this over.
No other
option. There's no sailing home. So, like...
I wonder if he regretted that at any point in time.
Just sit there going, you know what? Maybe I should have slipped on that one.
Just one? I could have kept one boat.
Even just for a souvenir.
Anyway.
And this week, Professor Ping tells us. Professor
Ping.
Now, on a more serious note, there was a... What do, like, New Mexican families need to really know about the Mini Mart Locos?
Mini Mart Locos, yeah. I think that was actually Ryan Clark kind of made that. It was like me and my brother Ryan Clark, we rode together every day. I don't know, he came up with that name.
This was your gang. I remember you telling. Oh, yeah, we had a
Because there was game. A lot of gang activity in Albuquerque, you know, Mexican gangs.
For real?
Yeah, and like where I grew up on the west side of town, I mean, it's bad. Like where I grew up, on there was drive-by shootings on my street, you know. Like, I grew up seeing a lot, you know, and I thought that's just how the world was until I moved away, you know, and saw, like, normal places, I guess.
It just reminds you how big America is.
Yeah.
Because people, you know, being from South Africa, people are like, what's America like? I'm like, it's like 50 different countries. Yeah, in there. Each state is like a different country. And inside that, there's I just came back from Maryland, and I was checking my navigation, and I almost rear-ended this Amish family in their buggy and wagon. I'm like, this shit still actually exists, you know, in this country.
Yeah, we're a weird melting pot here.
Yeah.
I just remember you talking about that when you first came out here, and I thought it was so funny. Ivan and his hard-ass gang. And I always think of it like random stuff will pop up. Yep. I'm like, yeah, Mini Martin
Logos.
That's
funny you remember that. Yeah.
I have a couple funny thoughts, too, in my head.
Yeah, we'll get there. I'm sure you do.
So when did you start going to amateur races and doing well there?
Well, we jumped head first into it. Like, I think it was 1990 when we bought bikes, and then we went to Ponca City that year, which was kind of like Loretta.
Just straight away.
Straight away. You know, like, I think I got like, I thought I was going to kill it, you know, I got like 30th place or something. But yeah, we just slowly, we kept on going, getting better. We had all those good guys in town, that I talked about that helped me kind of see how to do it. Ryan Clark actually helped me out a lot. Taught me how to ride, the rest is history.
That's amazing how much quicker your learning curve is when you got guys like that around, huh?
No, for sure. I mean, yeah, if I would have just been in Albuquerque and none of those guys would have been around, I probably would have never even got into it the level I did, you know?
Yeah, it's crazy. You always have all these influences that steer you one way or the other, you know? Could have gone, if all those guys were into
shapes
baseball,
your career.
Yeah, you know, you could have done something else. So what titles did you end up winning over your amateur career? You said you weren't like a...
Yeah, I never won Loretta's. I won motos there, but couldn't ever get it done. There was always a mud race, and I sucked in the mud. And
did you ever, at this point, did you have support, like decent support?
Yeah, actually, I was a Team Green kid on 80s, and then when I moved up to 125s, they told me I had to prove myself, and they wanted me to buy bikes, and I said, screw you, and I went and bought Yamahas. But then I remember I went one Mammoth that year, and then Yamaha started helping me. And
was it Bobby J's Yamaha?
Yeah, that was the local shop. So
didn't one of the guys, their parents own it? Or?
Yeah, Keith and Kevin Johnson, their grandpa actually started it, Bobby J.
Okay.
Actually, Keith he's actually running that shop now.
Oh, is he?
Yeah, he's living in Albuquerque running the shop, and I think he's doing pretty well with it.
Oh, good for them. I know Isaiah is a fireman now?
Yeah, he's a fireman
for Albuquerque Fire.
Then his brother Aaron Johnson works on the factory Kawasaki. Does all the
Aaron
ECU tuning.
Oh, I didn't know that was his brother.
Yeah. So I grew up with Aaron as well. He grew up racing, and he kind of more went. His dad was a mechanic, so he learned a lot from him, and that's kind of the route he took.
God, the Johnsons are everywhere.
Yeah.
Mom and dad were like humping left, right, and center.
Must have had a big Johnson.
Every show we got to circle back to fireman. It's like, where's Waldo? Where's the fireman in the group?
There's 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon and also fireman.
Fireman separation,
Ping comes back to something to do with educational and fireman, and I have to bring up something sexual.
Ping's always like wondering where he could get another job if he had to, so he has to mention all the firemen.
Yeah, he's just in case I wanted another one.
In Albuquerque, he's well-connected?
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
You got his card?
So what titles did you win then? Mammoth, you said?
Yeah, I won Mammoth. I won a lot in Vegas. You know, what do they call it?
World Mini.
Yeah, won there. Texas, I won a couple, like Mosier. Mm. But yeah, the big one, Loretta's, I could never get it done. And I remember when I was moving up
that's
to pro.
That's happened for a lot of people if you look at it. Like when you interview guys, how many guys go, man, I felt like I won everywhere but there.
Yeah. And I feel like it's all hinges on that one race, right? I'm getting a deal. Like,
and that weather.
Yeah.
Like you said, a lot of times you deal with weather.
Which is tough for like I talked about earlier, I was kind of supercross rider. Like I grew up racing a lot of supercross, and you can't really showcase that as an amateur, right? Mm-hmm. Especially back then, you didn't really have
Minios, maybe.
So I feel like there needs to be a better platform of supercross for the amateur kids to show their talent, to learn it, you know. And
well,
I don't know how you
supercross futures thing kind of does that.
Yeah, I guess that's true.
They've been bouncing around trying to figure it out. You know, they had the arena cross for a while, but that didn't work.
I don't
out
know
either.
What the best scenario is, because it is, I mean, you can't build a track for all skill levels, and you know, it'd be tough. But
dude, some of those arena crosses in first practice, we just used to go watch for the entertainment. I know it sounds bad, but I used to think I wouldn't want to be out there because you could have a head on because these guys are just launching bikes into the stands and everywhere. And you're going, yeah, this is not the best training ground either.
No. So I mentioned this at the beginning of the show. Like, I remember your first pro race.
Yeah.
It was Summercross.
Yeah, yeah.
1999. And I don't really, still to this day, I don't follow amateur racing super close. So I remember somebody going, oh, yeah, this kid's like really good amateur kid. He's just turned pro. Were you on a Yamaha or Suzuki?
Yeah, NCY Yamaha. That was my amateur sponsor, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, they were
Summercross.
They were into it.
I think I crashed six times in the heat race. Just, I mean, I was that kid. I was there like, I'm going to win this thing, you know? And I was fast, but yeah, definitely had to learn on the crashing end.
Crashed it up. So that was 99. What did you end up doing in 2000?
So 99, I did Loretta's A class. I had bike issues, had a horrible week, whatever. Yeah. Did the last three outdoors after that. And that was kind of when I had the light bulb go off for me. I went there thinking I was going to do good and got my ass kicked. You know, I mean, was tired, couldn't even hardly finish the motos. I was like, okay, I got to start doing some work.
Yeah.
So basically that was when the light bulb kind of went off for me and started really training and found some people to help me. And
like who? And what did you do the next year?
Well, I moved out here and actually Buddy Antonez was one of the first guys that kind of helped me. You know, okay. He's like, hey, dude, you need to start doing some stuff. He took me on some mountain bike rides and kind of just gave me like, dude, you need to start doing this, this, and this.
Yeah.
And that was kind of when I started training and things started going uphill for me.
Yeah. You had a pretty nice progression, too, over the years. Like, as I was looking at this, you ended up with Plano in, what, 01?
Yeah.
And it was like, you know, Plano to Yamaha of Troy to Mitch to the factory. Like, you kind of made these nice steps.
Which was good for me, I feel. Like, just there wasn't so much pressure at the beginning. I don't know if I could have handled it. And I think that's a lot of the guys. You know, you're so young when you turn pro, and it's so much to handle. And, you know, some guys can handle it, some guys can't, you know. Yeah. And
well, and you mentioned you're training Garrett Marchbanks now, who came from amateurs, and he was a pretty highly touted amateur kid.
Yep.
Straight to Mitch's rig.
Yeah. And it is a lot to handle.
And that's happened for a lot of kids, too. Mm-hmm. I think one of the things, and I've said it before, is some of these kids that are good at a young age, they're told and taught how to win and succeed and all that. And I've always said, but no one ever teaches a young kid how to handle defeat or failure. Yeah. You know, it's always, we're going to go win, we're going to... But what happens when we don't? Or when we get injured, or you lose that ride, and it's just... So people just kind of don't know how to handle it.
Well, I think you do kind of have to learn to lose, right? I mean, when you turn pro, if you're that guy that never lost an amateur...
You should have told Ricky that a long time ago. Yeah, it's okay to lose once in a while.
When you turn pro, for the most part, you're not going to learn to lose.
Yeah,
because that's
all
you're going to do for a while.
And that's, dude, I mean, some guys, if you've won your whole life, dude, that's hard to learn, right?
Yeah,
yeah.
So, yeah, and a guy.
I mean,
like,
didn't AC say he had a problem with that? He came off of winning every single thing, and then all of a sudden, whoa, okay, this isn't going the way I wanted it to.
But I think that's
who does? Like Stewart.
There's a few
RC.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a very small number of guys who come in and just start winning.
And I don't think nowadays I feel like there's more guys. Maybe I'm wrong, but I think it'd be harder to do nowadays than even back then.
There's more depth, and I also think, like, you know, this is the era that we're all racing. There wasn't a system like there is now. Like now there's almost like a system, you know, where I felt like for us it was like, hey, you mountain bike? Cool, let's mountain bike. We'll ride together. And now it's like they're going to leave at this time. They're going to do this much elevation. We've got our GPS and our navigation and our this and our that. And, you know, you're just like, wow, it's really come a long way.
Yeah. I agree with that.
So getting to your point, I agree. I think it's harder to come in and just do well.
And those guys that did that, again, they're the best. They're legends in our sport.
Just go look at the record books. Just go look at the record books. All the guys that came and dominated from the beginning are all the ones at the very top of the record books.
Even Jeremy. Like, he didn't. He had a couple seasons of learning and, you know, still rocking Showtime on his pants, but he wasn't winning everything, you know.
Well, his Showtime, I think, was more when he was at the river or something. Then it became his riding.
Those were probably some fun times, though. Late 90s. Oh, I caught the tail end of it, but
that was definitely a different
era for sure.
Supercross Sundays ring a bell?
Yeah.
All right, so how did you get onto the Plano Honda team? Was K-Dub involved back then?
Yeah. So he
was the manager?
That was the year they were starting. So
okay.
I was a Yamaha kid. It was kind of between me and Buckaloo for the Yamaha Troy ride. He obviously was better, so he got that. And Plano, they were starting this team, and they approached me. And it ended up being me, Travis Elliott, Paul Curry, and...
Sheik or Johnson?
I forget. No, that was later. That was later. I forget who the other guy was. But anyway, yeah, they just started the team, and they had Pro Circuit helping on the end. They were good bikes. It was a legit team.
Yeah.
Especially for where I was starting, I thought it was perfect.
And Kenny Watson was the team manager?
Yeah, he was the team manager. He's the one that, you know, built that whole program, basically. Okay. He had that shop. The Plano Honda was a shop outside of Dallas there.
Yeah.
And he wanted to start a race team. And
did you know Kenny prior to that?
No, that's where it all started.
Okay.
Yeah.
I didn't know how you guys – I know you guys have been tight ever since.
But yeah, we met there, and, yeah, we were tight all the way through.
Yeah. So how was that first season?
It was my first season was supposed to be 2000, and in the off season, starting in November, I dislocated my hip. So I had started with an injury, and then I broke my wrist twice, and then a collarbone. I had like four injuries in a row, so I missed the whole Supercross season my first year. And then I started during outdoors and was average or whatever, but then 2001 was my first Supercross season. So,
okay.
And that year I did pretty good. I got a podium. I think I got fifth in the series. You know, did pretty
good. We had a couple battles.
Yeah, that was your first year as well. Yeah. Yep.
That's right. 2001. Okay. I remember that.
I'm sure you raced too.
Yeah. That was when Ernie was on that
the Porsche
250F. And I'll never forget that year, San Diego Supercross in a heat race. He comes in, there's a 90 and then a triple right out of the turn. And he comes in and hits me, and we both kind of get squirrely. And I'm on a 125, so like, I'm not tripling. Like, obviously, I go down to first to double, right, or whatever. And he just downshifts to second, seat bounce it. And I'm like, that's it.
That's where he took me out in the main event. He hit a kicker. He ended. I went double. He nose-picked and then turned and just cleaned me out.
I remember that. Oh, yeah. Billy Payne was on the team in 2000.
Billy Payne.
Look at stats over there. You go. Look at you. You just chirping up every now and then.
Doing it.
That's right.
Yeah. There was another kid who was like his mic muted,
going, "Okay, Google.
Hey Siri. Hey Siri. Who's on Plano Honda?"
All right. So 2001, you had a couple of podiums. You said,
yeah, the last one, Salt Lake Supercross. I did. Yeah.
Okay.
Surprisingly, that was.
And how did the outdoors go that year for you?
2000. I mean, that wasn't great. I mean, I had maybe some top tens and some motos, but I wasn't that good at outdoors.
I know. I really wasn't. I wrote that down. You and I were kind of similar that way. Like, Supercross just came a little easier.
No, for sure.
And I was terrible in the mud.
Yeah,
and I remember you like hating the mud. We always would laugh about it. But then you figured it out, and I want to talk about that later. So let's go to 02. That's when you signed with
Yamaha Troy.
And that was Kehoe was managing, or was it Dang?
Kehoe signed me, but then that's when he left for Honda. And then Craig Dack, actually, from Australia.
That's right.
He came in and managed the team for just that 1 year.
Okay.
And, that dude's awesome. Craig Dack was awesome.
Yeah.
And that first year, it was me and Reed and Sellards. And
those bikes look awesome. Remember how awesome they looked?
I remember the whole
series. Yeah, amazing looking.
That was a fun team. We had a good time on that team. And I felt like our bikes were pretty good. And I think I got third in the Supercross series that year. I think Preston won, right?
2002?
Yeah, he did win.
Stewart got second. Yeah. I think I got third.
Stewart won a lot of races, but he crashed a lot that year.
That year was pretty good. But
you almost landed on me when my bike broke in half.
I did, yeah. I was right behind you when that thing broke.
You had
how many people think it was me that the bike snapped? I still have people. Dude, I remember I was there when your bike broke. I'm like, I've never had a bike snap. So it wasn't me. I'm like, you're thinking of Ping. Oh, yeah, okay. Yeah.
Or my wheel broke.
Did you see it?
Oh, yeah.
But I mean, in the air, were you like, oh, what's he doing or what?
I thought you just endoed off the triple. I had no idea.
I was in the stands, like, watching it. because I just thought he didn't even panic rev.
I couldn't.
And we found out afterwards. So he seized and snapped it.
IT's back there going, "What a squirrel! What's wrong with this guy?"
Well, dude, it was like, I wonder. It's just a dead sail.
And I'm where like, you were, you probably just saw the bottom of my bike.
Yeah, I thought you just endoed. I was like,
oh, this guy's dead.
Yeah, I split my chin open on that next triple there in practice. I remember on Friday practice, it was huge.
You remember that? Okay, right, so you landed off that triple. Yeah, yeah. There was like a double-double or a triple single.
And a 90.
A 90, and then a big triple. Yeah, do you remember peaked. Stu in practice?
Yeah, yeah. That's why I tried it, because I saw him do it.
Freaking Stu, dude. He was doing something crazy in those singles, too. Triple something, whatever.
Always, yeah.
And he makes the turn. Seat bounces this triple, which was like you had to go outside and just everything you had in lift. Even our KTMs were pretty quick that year. He's seat bouncing and just like upside down and like no problem. And I remember going, God, how, man, I can't even.
Yeah, yeah.
I still got the scar right there. It was one of those moments that just blew me away about how good he was.
No, he was, especially on the 125, man. He was unreal.
Just completely next level. Well, anyway, I don't mean to go off on a rabbit hole.
Yeah.
So that year, what about outdoors?
I was a little better that year, or on Yamaha Troy. Like, I started to figure it out, and 03, that's when we stayed at Sellards in Ohio. And I remember that was like, all right, I got to go somewhere and figure this out. Like, go to Ohio, go back east, and learn how to ride the mud ruts.
You had never gone back east?
No, I've always just been out here. I spent a little time in Texas, but, you know, that's not really, like, East Coast.
Yeah, it's a little different.
But I felt like even that summer, we mountain biked a lot. We did a lot. Like, I learned a lot that summer.
Yeah. You know,
and I felt like that carried into...
Did you also learn a lot of useless information? How to rebuild a dune buggy?
Volkswagen motor information.
Lots of good stories at the Sellards compound, for sure.
Well, all right. Well, while we're on the Sellards compound, let's talk about 03. Because there's stories that I still tell from that whole week. One, my wife showing your wife how to do a start on a 110. You remember that?
Oh, yeah. She ended up getting whiskey throttle later that day because she got a little overconfident.
It had rained out, right? And Teresa and my wife Amber were out riding the 110s around.
They were down by the mini bike track, right? Yeah, weren't they?
I think so.
Because I remember hearing commotion.
And so somehow or another, I had taught Amber how to do a start where you just, you know, you lift up into second, but you hold it up so it's still in neutral.
And then you just drop the thing, and it finds it.
Learned on the dirt. Or no, she learned on the pavement, but it had rained. So the asphalt was wet. So she'd spin, and she just thought that was super cool. So then she's out riding with Teresa, and it's dry asphalt. She's like, watch, I learned how to do a start. And she freaking lifts it up in a second, and just winds it up. Yeah. And the thing hooks up. And she's running behind the bike and, you know, does a full slide.
Yeah, and Teresa whiskeyed it just after that. She tried to go through some loops, got off the bat. I think they gave up after that.
Dude, they were out on the Honda Cubs jumping too. Remember that? Yeah.
Anyway, scary.
We had a lot of fun.
Remember I remember Ivan had bought this truck to get around and back east.
And, oh, yeah.
And then with a little liquid courage after we knew the championship was done.
The Ranger.
I bought it for $900 at, I don't know, Sellards had some.
He's got connections.
Yeah, he's got connections.
He knows some people.
So, yeah, that thing ran all summer.
Didn't you jump that thing?
Oh, yeah.
Every jump on the outdoor track.
Well, we were, it got dark, and someone's like, yeah, Ivan's jumping the truck. And I'm up on the patio deck, and I'm like, oh, I see the headlights. And I just hear,
it finally broke. And I left it there because we flew. I think we ended up leaving right after the party. So I left it there on the middle of the track, and I saw Brock years later, and I was like, hey, whatever happened to that Ranger? And he's like, I fixed it up. My mom drove it for like two more years.
Of course. Like,
Actually, I think the funniest thing for me though was when we were getting ready to go out that one evening, because the time thing is we get a phone call. Last race is canceled, so everyone's just like, yeah, we're here to party now. We've got no flights, nowhere to go, nothing to do.
The series was over. You just won.
You couldn't ride because everywhere was underwater. And so we're going out, and everyone's buzzed already. So trying to get like an entourage of people together is a nightmare. So we get out to the car, and I'm sitting in the passenger seat, and we're like, everyone here? No, Ivan's coming with us. I'm like, where's Ivan? So we wait. It's pouring rain. I'm like, I'm not getting out to go get him. So we're honking, but you couldn't see because where Brock's house is, there's no yard lights or anything. You got headlights, and it's pouring, so we can't see if he's standing outside the door even. Next thing, out of nowhere, IT comes hauling ass, jumps onto his butt on the hood, but it gives me a fright, and I swear, all I see is this guy go flying over the hood because the hood's so wet that he didn't anticipate how much slick it was. Goes off and like down this embankment. He comes, opens the door. He's just covered in mud and he's wet. He's like, "Let's go!" And I'm like, "What the hell was that about?"
I was tuned up. I was there already.
We went pretty.
It was
hard
just
that
the funniest
night.
Visual I had. Is just seeing you go flying across the hood of the car and disappear. And we're like, "Where is he?"
We had a big crew there though, because the Troy National was going to be that weekend, right? So everybody was in town.
Yeah, so you, me, obviously Brock, GL, Reedy was there.
Hanny
was there.
They were like some of the East Coast local guys, Brock's friends.
Yeah, a bunch of the Ohio guys.
It was more than that even, because I remember there was like
was
three
Was Casey
buses.
Johnson out there? No, he wouldn't have been there that time.
It's a top 15 of all the guys that would have finished.
There was so many people.
Yeah. Get out of control.
Do you remember we went to Walmart and we bought all the paintball guns they had? Remember that?
Yeah.
Then we went to Fred Andrews' store and bought
a bunch
of 110s.
The 110 races through the barn and stuff.
Whatever happened to all those 110s?
I left them with Brock, and I don't know. I ended up with one in my van, one out of the three or four.
He fixed them up and rode them for years. Still riding them.
I still have them.
His mom was riding them.
Yeah, it was just funny. Actually, I think Ping was the one that goes, "Hey, man, you're rich. You just got a fat bonus. Let's go get some bikes."
Well, I mean,
sounds like a great idea.
Great idea, right?
Let's do it.
You had just enough drinks in you. You were game for it.
How are we going to load these? We don't have tie downs. Never mind. Brand new 110s just laying on the sides.
Yep. Put them in. All right. So, what do you remember from that night?
Anything in particular?
I don't remember much.
I just remember it just being chaos. Like, it was raining.
It was the most random. We were racing bikes around in and out of barns, and then we're putting. Dish soap on the ground.
At a local little bar at the end.
The Red Onion.
Red Onion. Yeah, it was bad. It was bad.
Then that's where Henny got a little emotional because he was struggling on the four stroke.
I can't ride these four strokes. Yeah.
It goes bull wing every time.
Dude, that was a funny night.
I remember I was singing karaoke with Ellie Reed.
Oh, yeah. The Red Onion.
Yeah.
I think we ended up dancing with a chick that had like three teeth. That was awesome.
We were in Ohio.
those were the locals.
What's his town? I forget. What's that place called?
Sherrodsville.
Oh, well, Sherrodsville. Yeah.
Philly is the nearest, like, real town. But he's
where they have an actual restaurant.
Real town, yeah. Yeah, Sherrodsville. All right, so this is what I wanted to ask you. Before you went to PC, you kind of struck me as a Supercross-only guy. Then you ended up winning an outdoor title with him.
Yeah.
Did that surprise you? What changed? Like, how did you... I was always impressed that you evolved into that because that.
Yeah, I don't know. Like I think I progressed, but
you were like he said. It's like your career. You were like that sneaky guy that each year it was like, hang on, this guy's a legit contender.
Yeah, but I remember going into 05. That was the year Stewart was moving out into the big class, and it was kind of like, okay. It's open. Somebody new is going to win. And I remember they did a poll on Racer X. They said, like, who's going to win the 05 title? And there was probably 10 or 12 names on there. I remember my name wasn't on it. I remember thinking, all right.
I remember that.
It's
motivated
on.
You.
Yeah, oh, yeah, big time. And I remember thinking, and the season didn't start great. I was average. But I remember just thinking, dude, I'm going to pull this thing. It's going to happen. I think I was just confident, just made it happen. And
who did you battle with all year for that?
Well, this guy, he was better for sure, but he twisted his ankle right off the beginning of the season, and...
Yeah, that definitely made an impact.
Yeah, and...
You were West that year in 05?
No, we're East. Talking outdoor. Yeah, just outdoors. When him... It was the first round, Alessi, you went in for the pass on the last corner, I think, right there, and twisted his ankle around, and that kind of opened the door a little bit for me to kind of get in position. And
yeah, because I remember Hepler started pretty strong, and then he hit his head and had a couple crashes, and then like Alessi had a couple bad rounds, and then it seemed like when the season got going, you were just solid. Like even if you weren't winning, you were like second, third, fourth, whatever. You were just there every weekend. But we just grazed over. I think what was really impressive was for me was your 04 West Coast. I mean, I was like, oh, Pro Circuit's going to four strokes. It's going to be interesting. I honestly thought they would have mechanicals or something. And I went and watched, and I was just like, oh, wow. Well, I mean, you guys dominated.
Were you given, if I remember the story right, were you allowed to ride both, the 125 and the 250?
Yeah, actually, I signed thinking two-stroke.
We could always ask Bones who's sitting right here.
Oh, there's Bones right there. But I remember in October, I rode the two-stroke the whole October. and the thing was amazing. I remember thinking how good this thing was. But that was the year that they went to unleaded fuel. So that kind of killed the two-stroke, and I remember we were trying to work on that, and we got it better. But by that time, they started making the four-stroke, making some gains on it, and we did a bunch of tests. We went back and forth, you know, did a bunch of different tests, and that time I was still faster on the 125, but we were like, dude, this is the future. We got to just go.
Did you initially like the four-stroke? Or
no,
you?
I didn't. I hated it. Like
I was the same way.
I was a two-stroke guy, you know, grew up riding those things. I remember even at YOT, I jumped on one a couple times, and it just felt so heavy and just awkward to me. But
when you grew up on a two-stroke, man, that was a really different feel.
Yeah. No, it really
now,
was.
And they weren't. And they
but
were
now, if you get a two-stroke, does it feel weird?
Yeah, it feels real light, no front-end track. You know, it feels super awkward, so... But once the four-stroke started making some gains, I mean, dude, that thing was awesome.
And well, your bike, speaking of those seasons, 04, 05, like, I remember being up in the Knothole Club, which is pretty high up.
Yep.
And you came out of a turn right there out of the tunnel and jumped something. It was like, yeah. And it was you could so hear loud. The grunt. I was like, whoa.
But that year, man, that was, I mean, I almost went undefeated. You know, I only lost that one race at San Francisco. And I had the flu super bad that day, not like make an excuse. But and I almost won that night. I almost pulled it. I think I led it for 12 laps.
So yeah, I was 3 laps away from it. But both of those title runs.
The next year was a little bit more of a struggle in Supercross. Just had issues and stuff, but
yeah, still back to back.
Yeah, went back to back. And
so the outdoor thing, going back to that though, like how did you? What was the difference between years before and then that year where you just started getting some wins and?
Well, I think just winning in Supercross gave me some confidence, and just like I said, this the motivation of. People didn't think I could do it, you know, and I think my training started coming around. You know, I started working with Darren, my old trainer, Darren Stockton, the end of 03. So 04, I made some big gains, and then going into 05, it just felt like everything was just kind of coming together
also,
for me, you know. And
Ivan's pretty humble. He won't say it, but I was his teammate. He was a hard worker. I considered myself a relatively hard worker, but Ivan would always put in the time, put in the effort. One of the first at the track, one of the last to leave, you know, so he did a lot of stuff. Away from the track that people didn't see that I saw, which to me, I was like, you were doing all the right things and you were peaking at the right time.
No, for sure. And I knew I wasn't that guy that was just talent. You know, I knew I had to work, you know, and, you know, I did. I worked hard. You know, I feel like I could sit here and say I didn't slack the whole time. You know, the whole time I raced, I gave it my all.
Also,
I would agree.
At that season, at some point, the championship was still relatively wide open, say two-thirds of the way through the season. I think there was still I had a shot, Alessi had a shot, Short had there was like five six guys that realistically if they went on a run could have won, and then you came out and went back to back.
I
think it was your two wins of the year, right?
Colorado and Washougal.
And to me that was all of a sudden it just kind of put you on the map as like not a good guy but like championship
guy.
It was like you outrode everyone on those days, and it was definitely like I remember thinking that was kind of what set you onto that championship run there at the end.
For sure. I remember leaving Southwick, though, just with my tail between my legs, though. Like, so when I led it for, like, 20 minutes, you were on me, and I was just, dude, I petered out. I mean, you just...
I'm not going to lie.
By me, I'm like, dude, what? Like,
it was really hot.
Yeah, it was
moto,
really hot and really
the track
rough.
Was pretty rough, and I remember I was behind you, and I wanted to pass you earlier because I felt like I had more speed, but I was like... Are we going to be able to last?
Like, I definitely could.
I'm going pretty fast.
I was going as fast as he could, but then I was watching Ivan. I still thought, well, from my GP experience, I was looking going, I'm taking slightly better, smoother lines than that.
For sure.
I'm saving more energy. He is exerting. I mean, you were like pulling the bike over every roller. And then right near the end, I'm like, these guys are here. And I'm like, I'm going to just try and put in a couple sprint laps and hopefully I'll kill their spirit. And then everyone was like, dude. So that was my goal, was just to try and sprint. Because once I did that, I think everyone sort of took
but
the
wind
out.
But you were good in the sand, man. Like, that was definitely that race.
Southwick is one of those tracks where it's like in boxing when you're fighting a guy and you see him start to really mouth breathe.
Yeah.
At Southwick, you see a guy sitting down and, like, their kind of shoulders drop.
My favorite
one
is when they sit and then they bottom out in a whoop and it almost launches him back into a standing position.
Do you ever have John Dowd, you know, humiliate you there?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I think he was pretty old. Like, I think it was in 09. I was on Factory Honda. I think he kicked my ass that day. Like,
hey, don't worry. He kicked a lot of people's ass around
I think
place.
He got second.
At least it was John Dowd. I was getting ripped up by, like, dudes you'd never even heard of. Who are some of the local guys?
There's a few. Robbie Marshall.
Robbie Marshall.
There was some back in when I first turned pro.
There's like probably over the years, I don't know, a couple dozen guys.
Treadwell passed me one moto there, like when he was older. Oh, yeah. He's filled in on a KTM or something.
He filled
like,
in on my bike in 02 when I had my knee surgery. Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, anyway.
Southwick. That was...
Dude, when I went to Europe, that's how it was. I'm supposed to be a top GP rider, and I'd go to a local track, and they're like, oh, yeah, he's in the C class. And I'm like, he passed me. Like, like, what the hell?
All right. So... as far as the riding of the outdoors, sorry, I keep beating this up, but I want to know, like, what was there someone that was helping you with the outdoor stuff? Was it going back east and riding in the mud more?
Well, it was.
Because nationals are mud. And if you can't ride the mud, you're not going to do well in them.
I went back east to Ohio in 03. Then 04, I bought a motorhome and I went back. I had a van on the back, put my, you know, I just went back east all summer, both 04 and 05. I kind of based out of New York at Carpenters.
Okay.
But I would go to Southwick before that, go here, go there. And you know, I didn't jump on an airplane all summer, you know, and I felt like that was one of the biggest things for me. I needed to ride different tracks, you know, and just it worked for
me. Were you riding in the mud back there?
Yeah, I would ride whatever it was. Yeah. Like just whatever it was. Just.
Plus, to be honest, like you said before, the bikes were really good too.
Yeah.
So you were doing the right things, peaking at the right time, riding on the on I think the best team at the time, and like you said, I think the final straw, honestly, was you could start seeing the confidence in Ivan, and I still laughed when I saw that. I remember that article. I remember looking, and I'm like, they didn't even put Tedesco on there. He just won the West Coast. I'm like, interesting.
Well,
did they learn.
Those stupid editors, they don't know what they're talking about.
They did me a favor by doing that. Motivated me.
Yeah, sometimes those are the best things you can ever look at. It's something that gets under your skin.
But I carried that one with me for months, like, you know, just in the back of my head, you know.
When I was a kid in South Africa, there was a Yamaha ride up for grabs, and the guy gave it to someone else and told one of my sponsors, we just back winners. And I was so heated when I heard that, and then I went and won the title that year.
What was your bonus for that? What was your bonus for that year?
What's that?
The bonus for the outdoors.
Like money-wise?
Yeah. $1 million?
No.
Wasn't a million?
No, 1 million.
For outdoor?
I'm trying to remember Cowie's outdoor. Was it 250 or 300? It was around there.
Three.
I'm just saying that's a lot of motivation to
you know, for sure.
Huh.
Doesn't hurt.
I thought it was more for an outdoor title.
No.
That was maybe about the gun, right?
Probably, but...
Yeah, interesting. Okay. So, early PC 250s... did you ever have any scary moments? They were carbureted, so like...
Not so much on the bogging or any of that, just the things...
Let me guess, bombs, it was all this... Like, it was a suspension issue, wasn't it?
Yeah, all the suspension. That thing would kick me everywhere.
Kick you over the stockade.
But yeah, it was just, especially outdoors, it just, the thing, I would blow one up every other day, you know?
Oh, really?
And I was back east on the road, so I had bikes, I'd have like three or four engines on my van, go to the race, restock, you know...
Oh, wow.
And I was doing it myself. Me and Carpenter would, whoever's blew, because he was on a Cowie at the time, too. Whoever blew up that day, we would swap the motor. But it was pretty much every day we were swapping a motor.
Jeez.
How many motors did you go through that summer?
Dude, I mean, that year, probably, who knows? What would you say, 50? Easy.
Easily 50 motors?
50 motors.
Yeah, like,
jeez.
It was almost every day. I didn't know about that.
Would you hear it coming? Like, you'd tell something
sometimes,
going on?
But then sometimes, I mean, I remember Southwick Saturday practice. I had one. It went off one of those high-speed tabletops. Oh. And it blew a hole, like, this big in the front of the engine. But that thing just stopped. And, I mean, I ate it big.
Oh, you did?
Oh, yeah. So we had some crashes, too. Like, remember Walker had, or maybe it was Walker. Somebody else had a crash. Like, it was scary. Scary times for the four-stroke, for sure.
And then it sucks because it always dings your confidence when you go out there. You're just like, oh, I hope it doesn't grenade in the right spot.
Going, oh, right here's where it happened.
Or you come up to jumps and you have this tendency to roll off and lean back just for safety.
Hey, your bonus is that you wouldn't cover motors.
No, definitely not.
Well, the thing that I used to not like about riding the four-stroke when we were making that transition is a 125, a two-stroke would typically, it start to get slow. You kind of, okay,
you knew it was going coming. On.
Yeah, typically. Unless your piston cracks in half.
Yeah.
But a four-stroke's just like, bang.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's scary. For sure.
Like you said, ticking time bomb's the best way to explain those.
But luckily for 05, we figured it out. I didn't have any DNFs that summer, you know. That's all it would have taken.
Well, they weren't at the very beginning of that. I mean, that was just trial and error.
Yeah.
build it until it doesn't run anymore.
But luckily, like, Mitch was willing to throw that kind of money into it to make it happen, because if he wasn't, I mean, we wouldn't have won. You know?
Well, his hiring of Drino Miller, I think, was the big catalyst. He was so far ahead of everyone. Pro Circuit was like, if you weren't getting your engines done there.
No, for sure.
Good luck. You weren't even getting it. You weren't going to have a chance. People finally caught up, but anyway. What are some of your best memories of that era? Like when you were winning, shit was going great. I was trying to think of some of like the funny stories back then. And I want to say you and Brandis went into that bar in Canyon Lake in your bicycle shorts, your rubber bike shorts.
Brandis was crazy, right?
Like he was a wing.
But he was that one guy. He could talk me into doing some stupid stuff. I don't know. He was one of those guys. Yeah, but I lived with Casey Johnson at the time. Yeah, and sitting around. He lived up there by Canyon Lake. We're sitting on a Sunday or something, having some beers, and he comes downstairs in his road bike spandex. He's like, "All right, let's go to the bar." I'm like, "What do you got your spandex on?" Like, he was all about it. He had a bandana on too. But he talked me into going too. We went, and the dude at the front wasn't gonna let us in. He's like, "What are you guys doing, dude?" Like, and Brandis wasn't.
Why are you guys being assholes?
He wasn't taking no for an answer, dude. Finally, we get in there with our spandex on, and he's.
What was that part? Was it Coyote Ugly or Coyote something?
Whatever it was, it was. One of those.
It changed. It's changed. Flipped named a couple
up
times.
Hat. Everybody thinks they're tough. Yeah. You know, like one of those places. Canyon Lake.
Pedro's or.
I think maybe
Pepe's.
One of those.
Pepe's.
Yes.
I think Pepe's. It was Pepe's. Yeah. Yeah. Definitely people were.
It was Bro Central because it was like Canyon Lake Bros. Yep. And you guys come rolling in
lifted rubber trucks shorts and flat bills.
Oh, and tons of golf carts there parked on the
front. Yeah.
A good time. That guy was. He's a good time.
But on the plus side, that was where a good. Good spot to go pick up chicks in your earlier days, you know, because they were a little, maybe you didn't take them home to mom, but you know, you knew they were up for a good time.
You took them home.
Yeah. Just not to mom.
Just no mom. Yeah.
Yeah, you lived up in Tuscany Hills as well.
I was above you guys.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. So there was a big crew of us up there. Like, I think Hanny lived up there, or did he live with you?
Yeah.
That's right. He did.
Yeah, I remember that one. That's him funny. And him
at
and Brock.
One point, I lived with Casey.
Yeah.
When my house was
up,
being built.
Up there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it was, you were the next street up. Hanny was living with you.
And Brock.
Had you already moved out by then?
I didn't move out until we went in 04. Yeah, I was up there for a while.
So you were up there.
Yeah.
Remember when Hanny put diesel in your
gasoline
diesel. Truck?
How could I forget?
It blew it up?
No, it just
boogered it.
Luckily at the time, he was a cheap ass and only put 10 bucks in or whatever because he didn't feel
I made him.
Up.
He's like, "Hey, you got any cash?" I'm like, "No, you are going to put." And he's out there and he's like, "It's not going in." And I'm like, "Because you're an idiot."
Yeah.
But I didn't look.
Got some in there. Like.
And he's like, I'm like, that old saying, if it doesn't go force it, so he just shoves it in, puts this diesel and he goes, "Hey, should I go through the planner on the way out?" I'm like, "Do it."
Yeah.
He goes, "Whoa!" And the truck goes, "Boo!" And we're just sitting in this planner, and a cop comes by. "You guys all right?"
"Yeah." Yeah, I pull up to the next day to the Yamaha track, and they're all sitting on their tailgates. My truck's like barely running up the hill. They're all laughing their asses off.
I just remember we were all going to the test track, but I was going to the KTM one. You're going to Yamaha, but... I still remember what joke I said, "You might want to leave about 20, 30 minutes before us."
Yeah, and I had no clue.
And he's like, "What do you mean?"
Yeah.
He gets in, he goes down the road.
Was it just jerking the whole time?
Yeah.
The whole time.
So I just kept filling it up with gas, and it finally cleared up.
Your injectors are just all gummed up. Jeez.
Hanny.
That sounds about right.
Oh, there were some fun times back then.
Okay, so... Talk about your first jump to 450s. Signed with Suzuki. How'd that happen? How'd that come about?
Well, I was talking to everybody. I was talking to Honda, Cowie, obviously, because I was on PC.
It's funny what a couple titles will do, huh?
Yeah.
Talking to everybody.
Yeah, and I don't know. Like, I went the Suzuki route just because, I don't know, Roger and those guys, just like, I felt like they believed in me. You know, the meetings I had with them, they were different with Cowie. They were like, "Yeah, we'll give you a deal, but..." I don't know, Roger really believed in me. That's why I signed that deal, and it was good. I felt like...
That bike was, at the time, was the bike, too. I mean,
it was good. The only thing I feel, looking back on it, is the bike was kind of catered to Ricky, you know? Mm. And, you know, I feel like that happens on no matter what team you're on. The premier rider, you know, everything's kind of guided towards that rider, and I don't know. I felt like my bike could have been a little better, but...
They didn't work with you on stuff that you wanted?
They did, but, you know... Not as much as you'd like. Yeah. You know, I think, but that's like that on every team. It's just the way it is, you know.
I felt a little bit like that when I first went to Yamaha. I felt like they'd gone down a road with Chad, and when I came along, they're like, yeah, but that's the suspension we have, and it was oversized, and it was oversized clamps, and I'm like, no, I want flex, I want feel, I want everything smaller.
Yeah.
It was kind of like, we've made our decision, like, this is what we got from Japan, that's it. So you had to start from there and
try
almost
to
work your way back to where you want to.
No, for sure.
They're like, here's this subframe. It's 3 inches shorter, but don't worry.
Yeah. You're like sitting on it. Your knees are all bent.
Everyone on the team loves it.
but it was good.
There's no padding in the seat. I don't know why there's no padding in the seat.
My rookie season was good. I got fourth in the series. You know, was on the podium. Yeah, I was solid, consistent.
Yeah.
I got hurt at the last in Vegas, blew my shoulder out, so I didn't ride outdoors that first year, but going into that next season, my second year, you know, Ricky was retiring, or he went to part-time, he was retiring, and kind of was like, okay, it's your time to win. That offseason, I was ready. Like, I'll be honest,
good that, yeah.
Like, I was ready to go and be a contender, and like, even Ricky tells me that to this day, and I went to the Canadian rounds, Toronto, and
Stuart landed
on my hand in practice, and I mean, that was 6 weeks from Toronto to Anaheim 1. So I basically, you know, my hand was crushed, I think, in three places or whatever. And
what happened there? He just...
I don't know. I was behind Ricky, you know, just second lap of practice. And, dude, he just jumped right on, just landed on me. Just jumped right on me. And, you know, I went over to him and tried to get an explanation. You know, like, dude, like, you know, I was heated, obviously, ready to kill him. You know, I'll come talk to you later. And he never said anything, whatever. You
really?
Know, was a peckerhead about it, but
you're never a Stu fan.
Not from that point, you know, I wasn't. No, just because of how he handled that, you know, like for me, that was like a big blow I took to my career. I felt like, you know, and it just wasn't really respect about it. You know, he didn't come and talk to me.
Well,
about
a simple,
it,
like, hey, sorry, dude, I didn't see whatever, you, or you know? I drifted, or
but well, anyway,
that, in that, his defense, you're not the first guy he landed on.
No, for sure.
I had you wouldn't be the last.
Right? I had a heated conversation. Well, brief one because he just rode off. But like after the heat race in that year in Phoenix, because he had cross jumped me a couple times and I was not okay with that. And same thing, he just looked at me and rode off and didn't say anything. And I just was like, really? Mm. Okay, cool. I know where we stand now.
And I mean, we had our run-ins our whole career or whatever. He was always way faster than me. I couldn't beat him straight up, but I definitely tried to hit him when I could.
Oh yeah. Ever since that, you kind of
for sure, for sure.
He did that to a lot of people though.
Yeah.
James never told me to ask him, really, though. Like he was the kind of guy he didn't deal with confrontation. He just
ignore it. Yeah.
Pushed it off to the side.
You know who said you got to ask him about the Canada was Travis Preston.
Yeah. I don't think that later that night he had issues with.
Oh,
him.
When That's he came when, back on the track.
Yeah.
Stewie jumped back on the track. Preston was coming over the finish.
Him and Chad or something clipped or
Ricky. Didn't he grab him by the helmet or something?
Yeah.
I think he got in trouble for that too.
And he landed on Preston at Anaheim 1 year after it was a rhythm section. There was sand and he was going into a corner and Stewie landed on Preston there.
I think it wasn't the first time Preston and him had come together.
Yeah.
Travis is not a fan.
No, he's not.
I don't think Ricky's a fan.
No, I think
there's quite a few people who...
I like Stu because we became kind of... buddies when I was at Cowie, you know, when I was at PC and he was Cowie, we became kind of buddies. And I don't know, after I signed with Suzuki, I feel like he just kind of wrote me off, you know, like, which I guess.
So you didn't always have problems with him, just.
No. Like we had times where we were cool, yeah, for sure. Like if I saw him now, I wouldn't be cool, you know, of course.
Well, it was funny, I rode at his house, and so I thought, okay, you know, like getting along, obviously. And I'm like, hey, you want to grab dinner? Oh, no, I'm good. I was like, okay.
I see where we're at.
I'm just kidding.
No, in fact, I don't even think he said that. I think his brother came and said, oh, no, he's just going to eat at the house. I'm like, oh, okay. I guess we're not really in that zone yet. Hey, I gave it a shot.
That's really funny, man. All right, let's take a quick break here. We're about halfway through. This is going to be your TLD timeout. Grab a drink. Grab a bathroom break. We'll be right back with more Ivan Tedesco.
At Nihilo Concepts, we have a passion for innovation and for motocross. Our mission is to develop parts that will improve the durability, functionality, and the appearance of your motorcycle. We're proud to say that everything from Nihilo is made in the USA in our state-of-the-art manufacturing facility in Stuart, Florida. Whether you race every weekend or you just ride for fun, Nihilo offers high-quality, innovative parts that you just won't find anywhere else. Nihilo offers custom engraved engine covers, one-piece titanium foot pegs, brake tips, internal engine components, specialty tools, frame grip tape, carbon fiber components, and so much more. Check out our website, NihiloConcepts.com, and see for yourself why teams like Red Bull KTM, Rockstar Husqvarna, Troy Lee Designs, and some of the fastest riders in the world choose Nihilo Concepts. NihiloConcepts.com.
Hey guys, welcome back to the Whiskey Throttle Show. That was your TLD timeout. Be sure you get over to TLD, their website, troileedesigns.com. Check out all of the new SE, the SE Pro, SE Pro Air, GP, GP Airlines. Everything is out. Their stuff for 2020 is amazing. So get over there and definitely check it out. Getting back to Ivan Tedesco, we kind of glazed over something that I want to go back on. Your 05 championship run, outdoors. The last round at Glen Helen. And we talked
came, as you can imagine, this came from a boatload of fans.
Yeah, we got that one. If I didn't bring this up, we were going to get like a mob over here to kill us. But and we talked about this with Bones when he was on a little bit, but that last round with Alessi, what a weird deal, huh?
Yeah, like that day was supposed to be, you had a 35 point lead going into the last round. Okay, figure I'll wrap it up the first moto, thinking, but first lap of the first moto, Hepler had a crash, and I ended up landing on his bike, and I ate it big. Like, luckily, I didn't get hurt.
Where was that at? Was it
in the back part of Glen Helen? That back tabletop.
Yeah, the rollers.
Yeah, the rollers.
You used to go to that Bud's Creek. They used to call it.
Yeah, so it was a high speed big crash. Remember, I was scrambling to my bike, obviously, because what was at stake, and go to take off, and I just hear grinding. I look down, my chain's off. Like, are you kidding me? So I put my chain back on, roll it back and get going again. I'm just thinking the whole time my chain's going to derail, But with what was at stake, I had to go. I rode the whole moto, got 21st.
Oh.
No points. Alessi wins the moto. I think you guys had some drama that moto, right?
I won the moto, but then
he got the points for the moto somehow. Like, they docked you or something?
They docked me, and then what happened later in the day, they disqualified him, so I got... I went 1-1, according to the record. So.
GL took a different route on the track at one point.
But in the moment, he got the 25 points. It went from 35 to 10 points going into that final moto. And, man, that changed for me. Obviously, I went in there pretty mellow, and then I knew I had to make it happen that last moto. And
how bad were you freaking out between motos?
Pretty bad, but not much was said at the truck. We had a little powwow, but nothing crazy, and...
Did they swap motors or suspend? Was anything bent?
I didn't even pay attention. I couldn't even tell you on that end. But I remember I obviously got 21st gate pick. I was a little further outside, and I think Mo was next to me, Morris. And I remember saying, "Dude, just let me go." Basically, But I ripped a start. I think I was second, and I took a look back just to kind of see where everybody was at. I think maybe Villa was out front, and saw Jeff Alessi behind me. I'm like, okay. And he went for a move, obviously, but I knew he was there, so I kind of checked up.
And I was right behind that.
Yeah, and then I took another look back, and I didn't see Mike anywhere. So I was like, all right, I'm good. But then in that mud straightaway where he must have just...
He hit me in the corner before.
And he must have never shut off. I don't know.
I had a view from it. My view was opposite of where Bones was. I was kind of up where the REM parking is.
Yeah.
And I remember just kind of watching him come. I'm like, and then it was just...
And if you see that, there's a picture of kind of the explosion. I mean, he hit me probably going, I don't know how fast. It was an explosion.
I saw it coming because you talked about that muddy straightaway. Yeah. Everyone was going either way left or way right. and I think you were way left.
Yeah.
And I was also in that left lane, but he'd kind of stuffed me in the corner before, and he was on the right side. And I was looking at the right, and I remember he never slowed down.
Yeah. And I remember just, luckily he didn't break my leg or, you know, whatever, but remember I got hit, and I got up. Obviously I knew it was him, and then he's trying to keep me from getting my bike. Everybody's seen the video, but he's putting his, he puts his handlebar in my front wheel.
That was the crazy part. Yeah, he lifts his bike on.
I
gave him a shove,
but I remember thinking I wanted to kick his ass, obviously, but I couldn't do
anything. Then you're thinking, I can't
do anything. I can't do anything. I just had to sit there. I just remember saying, keep your bike running, keep your bike running, which I did. And I got up, and I think I finished 11th that moto.
Did he take off in front of you?
I got up first.
Okay.
And I remember thinking, I'm good as long as he's on the ground with me. Nobody else can.
There was no one else, right? Yeah.
So yeah.
Did he ever get back up to you?
No. Okay. No. I remember I went. I got up to like 11th, I think, that moto, and he ended up crashing, I think, or something later in that moto.
If I remember right, didn't Walker turn around when he passed you guys and drops his bike, and he's like,
yeah. And then before the moto, he was like, dude, I got your back. And I'm thinking, okay, whatever. Like, but he had my back.
That was
dude.
Pretty cool.
No, it was. Like, he turned around and tried to help
me. Walker's an interesting character.
We really need to get him on the show because he's
really
interesting.
He
stopped and helped you. And I want to say he got in trouble for that.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
And then later that moto, he had
broke
a
broke his jaw.
Because I went and saw him in the hospital. I remember, I think his face was swollen, big.
Yeah.
So you finished that moto out. I mean, not the day you probably hoped for. I imagine, you know, you're like,
but it's cool. It's cool. I mean, you win it. It's a little more dry. It's cool, right? It's a good story. We're still talking about it.
Well, yeah.
But
right.
Definitely a stressful day, you know, especially how much that outdoor title meant to me, you know. Like, I never thought I would win one. So, yeah, it was cool to pull it.
Did you ever have a word with the Alessi camp? Anybody over there?
He tried to come in the truck at, like, later, like, to congratulate me, but
you'd have kicked him right out the door. Yeah. Just big giant karate kick right out the door.
I mean, it's like, how do you even come over at that point, dude? You pulled your bike over on top of mine and then stood on my bike. Like, come on.
He had a mental meltdown.
I mean, I could almost forgive him coming in and trying to take you out. He was doing what he had to do.
No, for sure.
It was the aftermath. Yeah. Like, get up and go.
Anybody would
have, you know,
go up for the win. Yeah, go for the
takeout. I just think that he just totally panicked. I mean, that family just revolved around being a champion. And when you watch it back, all I can think of is he just panicked. Because him pulling his bike onto you, I'm like, what are you doing? After you've cleaned the guy out, you're supposed to get up and beat him by five positions because you need 10 points. Like, so I don't even think he knew what he was doing.
Well, standing on the bike and pretending like he was trying to get his bike up while standing on your bike.
I think he's sitting there going, how do I keep him here? I want to go, but I don't want him to go. But you got to imagine he went from like, okay, I don't really have a shot at this title to
all of a sudden,
you know, Tony's just going, this is yours. You got it. Yeah. This was meant to be, you know, blah, 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 just in his ear the whole time. So anyway, drama.
Yeah, crazy day.
Okay. So we've covered it, people. No nasty letters and emails. So that we were talking about your first year at Suzuki. You did have an awesome season. That was your best supercross finish ever at fourth.
It was, yeah.
And you missed the outdoors, right, you said?
That year I did. And then I think I got fifth in the series, supercross, the following year. And I raced outdoors, but was kind of average. I mean,
and so in 07, that was when RC did half the year, right?
Yeah, that was when he did part time. Yeah.
So, and I know you guys got to be really close during that time. You were working with him a lot. What did you kind of glean from him? You take anything away from him? Did he help you?
Yeah, he helped me a lot. You know, I spent 2 years down at the farm and did all that. I don't think it was 100% for me, their program. I think you either mesh with it or you don't. You know, I've always been a hard worker, but I don't know, it was a little over the top for me, you know, the program they had me doing. And I felt like I kind of cooked myself. In 09, I kind of cooked myself. You know?
Especially in that humidity, doing it day in, day out. It's hard.
Yeah, I mean, it didn't work for me, you know. But they have a good program down there. And I think some guys work well there. Others don't. I think you've seen that, you know, guys that have gone there.
So I think what's a really disturbing trend, and it started back with Ricky, you know, in his program, is we've seen so many guys just torch themselves.
Yeah.
And it's like, it's hard to argue with Alden's numbers. These guys are winning every single freaking year. But, man, look at all the number of guys that either their careers get cut short, they look sick. They're so skinny and bags under their eyes. And then you look at the number of guys we have that have Epstein-Barr. Someone else just came out and said they have Epstein-Barr. Bogle.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just more and more guys, I think, we're losing sight, or guys are losing sight of recovery and the importance of that. And we've got this, if a little bit's good, more is better.
What's come,
and it, even more is more better.
It's come the same thing there, even. It's train more, train harder, train. And, like, it's the same thing. They're not being taught. Recovery is almost as important as your training, because I think we've all shown up to a race just like, I don't know, but I feel like flat, you know?
Yeah, 100%.
And then it's worse than being out of shape.
It really is. But it is a fine line, though, right? Of too much work, not enough, yeah. You know? But that, I think
you've got to feel,
you can't write yourself. It down on paper like, here, do this, you're going to be a champion. You got to find out who you are, you know, personality too. Like, everything comes into play, I feel.
Totally.
You know, and to be a champion or to go win, to get the best out of yourself, you got to find that program. Like, I found that in 04, 05, I felt like, you know, when I was winning.
Okay.
Anybody that wins, I feel like they figure it out. They find it.
And I think it's interesting because it's all mental, right? Like, you're doing all that physical stuff. It's good for your fitness, but it's better for your head, right? And I think that's the big component that Alden does with his guys, is he's like, all right, we've literally measured and weighed all your food. We've done more work than anyone. You've ridden more laps. Like, there's no excuses you're going to win, you know. You know what I mean? That's his deal.
Yeah. That's why I said I think he's been good for a lot of people. It's just when they go there, it's like, well, I believe in myself. I got the right team and I got the right trainer. Like, nothing can stop me. So you get that. I think there is that sort of
takes
mental
the thinking
advantage
out of it a little bit for you. Yeah.
But then even then, you know, it didn't work out with Cincerello. Didn't work out with Roxon.
Yeah.
Comes back to, like I even said, no, you guarantee. Can't write on a piece of paper, this is what everyone needs to do and you'll be a champ.
Well, there needs to be a little bit more science into the recovery and the training. I'm actually doing a thing with Rob Beams right now. I don't know if you know, familiar with him from Florida.
Yeah, I remember Rob,
And we're working on a he's going to put me through this little program that he does that sort of measures your sleep analysis. I'm getting this weird watch I got to wear all the time, and we're going to do blood work and the whole thing. But it's like,
I told you're becoming like one of those guys.
He's so frustrated that these guys, in this day and age, when there's science to figure out where you're at, right? Yeah. Like, your resting heart rate, these watches will tell you how long you were in your REM 3 sleep cycle. I mean, they'll tell you everything. So you can scientifically break it down and go, okay, I'm rested and I need to get my ass up and work today. Or, hey, today needs to be an easy day. You know what I mean?
No, for sure.
That science is there. We shouldn't have guys going, I'm just roached. I can't even race this weekend.
I did that a couple times. Have you ever done that where you wake up, check your heart rate, and if it was higher than you liked, you just knew, hey, I'm not some. It either meant you were burnt out or getting sick.
Yeah.
So I just
usually the numbers, how you feel, the numbers make sense usually. Yeah. I mean, sometimes they don't, but for the most part they do.
I had some days where I'm like, 42, shit. I just want to keep sleeping, but that's my right number. All right. Yeah. Let me check it again. 42.
You're like this.
Trying to get it to go over there.
Yeah, 50. Yeah, I'm burnt out, man.
That's funny. All right, so we covered that one. What about the switch to Honda? Yeah, why? What happened there, and how did it come about?
For me, like, I struggled a bit in 07. You know, like, I was supposed to be the guy once Ricky moved on. Yep. I was supposed to be the guy to move up, and it was kind of an average year for me. You know, like,
fifth in supercross wasn't bad.
Yeah, but, like, just I was supposed to be better.
Right.
You know? And I felt like I should have been better, but... So, I don't know. I felt like I needed a change.
Do you think it was the hand injury that just started the season off on the wrong foot?
I think so. I mean, it's easy to point at that, but yeah. And I know that then once I wasn't doing as well, just the dynamics with the team, with Roger, you know, it just kind of changed for me. You know, I felt like they kind of lost faith in me. And I had Kehoe at Honda who was calling me and telling me he wanted me. He believed in me. I don't know. I wanted to be somewhere where they believed in me, and I felt like that with Honda. Yeah. So, you know, that was why I went that route. And obviously it didn't work out. I had an okay season in 2009, but, you know.
Those bikes weren't awesome that year.
The 2009 was a struggle.
I was working with Townley here, and, dude, we changed. Bones left, but when he was here, we went through, I can't even tell you how many triple clamps and different races. And
it was just it was a bad bike to begin with, you know, and – We tried. They tried, but it was a struggle for sure.
It was like the stink.
Yeah, it was like a funny car. That's what I call it.
Yeah, I remember. I remember even the plastic didn't help it any bit. They could have even molded the plastic a little different, but yeah, it did look weird. What do you think was your? I know you said wasn't the greatest time there. What was your best memory
From Honda?
Yeah,
probably going to Des Nations in 09. You know, that whole summer was pretty good for me. I won a race, was on the box almost every week. But I started the season at Glen Hill, and I knocked myself out the first moto of the year. So I DNF'd the first race. And then as the season went on, I mean, Reed ended up winning the title. But I was still, if I could have done something that first race, maybe been in the title hunt. You know, that was the one summer on a 450 where I was on the box every week, you know, a contender. But that first round just kind of put me at a deficit. But that, and then I went on to Italy, and me, Dungy, and Weimer did the designations. That was a pretty cool race. Yeah.
And you did that three times and won it all three times, right?
Yeah,
twice
yeah.
with Mitch and then once with Honda?
No, once with Mitch, once with Suzuki.
Okay.
I filled in for RC because he hurt his shoulder at Glen Helen. That was like, yeah. It was last minute. It was 06. Yeah, because I didn't race outdoors that year. I got shoulder surgery.
Okay.
That was at Glen Helen watching. And him and Stuart were battling, I remember, and Ricky had a crash and blew out his
Practicing?
Shoulder. It was during the moto.
Oh, during the moto.
Yeah.
Okay.
On the uphill going on where the horseshoe is.
Is that where he went over the fence?
Oh, yeah. No, that was on the start. That was on the start where he went over the fence.
That was okay.
He blew his shoulder out.
Bad, yeah.
I remember going back to the truck, and Roger's like, hey, think you'll be able to race in 2 weeks, you know, Des Nations? And I'm like, I guess.
You hadn't been even riding at that point?
A little bit, you know, but the bike was already there. Like, it was 2 weeks away. You know, they basically, like, this is their only chance, like, send him. I'm like, yeah, I'll do it. Let's go.
I remember some people were like, oh, the U.S. is not going to win. Yeah. They sent the B team.
Dude, and I remember.
You impressed a lot of people.
Yeah. A lot of, and we
that
did
That was France that year, right?
England. And what was that one?
06, yeah. Was England?
Everett's last race.
Merrily Basin.
And it was dry. It didn't rain that year there.
Right. It rained a little bit early in the week because it was a little. The track was pretty rutted.
It was.
I remember watching Everett go the long way around. Stuart standing with his feet in the peg, looked like his trail riding.
I just meant it wasn't like completely blown out.
No, it
like
wasn't a mud race.
England, it was like dusty, pretty much.
But I remember the Thursday before that, we flew in and tried to shake down the bikes.
What did you bring? Just your own suspension? What else did you bring?
Taller seat, subframe.
Another subframe.
Whatever my setup was. I don't even think I did any testing. Maybe just whatever. Yeah, like.
How were you feeling before you went? You obviously started riding.
I went home that next day. I like crunched it for like that week and a half. Like went and rode. Like, and everybody else is, you know, the season's over. So I'm out there by myself just trying to figure it out. Like, God, this is going to be a struggle. I remember we on that Thursday before we flew in, went to shake down the bikes, and I accidentally slept late. I showed up late to the test, and everybody else is already done riding. So everybody's sitting there watching me ride. Then it was like a rocky English crappy track.
Yeah,
I was jet lagged. Probably looked like a novice the way I felt. I remember just the look on everybody's faces, like guys brought this guy, like
this one, huh?
But you know, the first moto, I led it for 20 plus minutes, and I got some bad arm pump. I mean, I get wrong, but we pulled it off. We made it happen.
So three different times you went over and you won. Take us through each one. The first year, 04 or 05?
It was 05. 05, okay. Erne, France. It was me, Carmichael.
That's the one I'm thinking of, yeah.
Carmichael and Wyndham.
That was a neat one, huh? It had to be.
Yeah, because we hadn't gone since pre-9/11,
yeah.
I believe.
9/11, you know, they canceled and they didn't go 02. 03 was when they were meant to have it here.
Yeah.
And they got canceled.
So we hadn't been in a while, hadn't won it in a while. So it was kind of a big deal us going back. And, you know, it was a cool team with having Carmichael and Wyndham. And you've seen Erne.
It was incredible, crazy
venue. And, yeah, I'll never forget that one.
Good,
you know,
crowds
that off.
And everything.
One of your best, one of the highlights for sure.
100%. Yeah. Yeah, that was cool. Because I never experienced nothing like that before. Europe, you know, that level of, it's different over there. You know, like it's, like we've had designations here, but I don't know. The atmosphere is different.
It's like going to a soccer game here or a soccer game in Brazil.
Yeah.
They literally
or even
kill
go to
the
soccer
ref.
Game in
or
Europe.
England. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's the same thing.
Definitely some of my best memories are those designations for sure. But the pressure of it, though, that race isn't fun. I'll be honest. Like,
I can't imagine.
That race is not fun as an American until you win, if that makes sense.
Yeah, because really you're expected to win.
It's not enjoyable.
For me, it was like, we're not expected to do anything. Let's just go have fun.
Yeah.
So
like those guys this year, I mean, yeah, I get it. It's a tough one. It's a lot of pressure. You know, if you don't win, it's a failure.
What's your thoughts on it, though? Because, yeah, you do have that. We're just expected to win, which really, at this point, we shouldn't be. but you've got a track that's, I don't want to say it's designed for the Dutch guys to win, but
it's going
to
be a tall order this year.
Right? A tall order. Like, what do you think of the drama? You know, like we talked about it last week where the guys that turn it down now there's, you know, the chatter on the message board is, oh, Kawasaki's just covering for Eli and, yeah, and Adam. They don't want to go, and they're just having Cowie take the lead.
I get it with Adam. I mean, looking at the bigger picture, he's moving up to the 450 class. You know, like, I get
totally
it.
Makes
that
sense.
Race is what, almost a month out?
Yeah.
I don't know how far it is from the last race, but you got to keep it going that extra month. I get it, you know, but to sit there as a fan, I get it. It's easy to sit there and criticize everybody, too. Like,
Did you ever have any reservations about doing it? Like,
I never did, just because, skirt, let's go, let's do it. You know, I never had that, like,
yeah.
If I have the opportunity, I'm going to take it. That's kind of how I always thought about it.
It's tough because I see the business side of it. These guys trying to like squeeze their career into this little window. You got, 10 years is like the average, right? So you got to really make hay while the sun shines. And you're going to send a guy and say you're going to definitely not going to get a break this year.
Yeah.
You're going to lose testing time to everyone else for Supercross. You're not going to get paid a dollar. But if you win, we'll be stoked. And if you don't, you're going to get
so
much
shit
talked
on anyway.
Yeah, everyone's going to hate
you.
I mean,
and that's all true. I mean, you know, across the board. Like, but that's the reality of it.
Here's what I'd like to see. I saw a big press release saying the FIM and MX Sports are working hand in hand to be better, united, and this and that. Can't they get a better schedule for donations as well? I mean, can't they try and work with us? But at the same time, I feel like they're not going to do anything to help the Americans.
Yeah.
Because it's mostly a European.
But that's foolish. If you want the best guys there, you've got to give us. You got to at least bring it back a couple weeks our direction.
Yeah. Because keeping your training and all that for a month.
Forget it.
Like nobody wants to
do
that.
No.
I remember in 09 it was like that. It was pretty far out, and I remember just being like, "Yeah, I got to keep this going." Like,
yeah.
I mean, I had the motivation of my country, like all that going, but it was a struggle.
Yeah, you're thinking like, God, everyone else is in Hawaii right now, or like recovering, healing injuries, and you know,
all they're doing is just basically catering around the GPs. So it's that they're essentially creating a European motocross of nations because that's all that it really suits. Everyone else from around the world has to travel there, whether you're South African, Australian, South American, whatever. Yeah. You always got to go there, and they go to the same three or four tracks now over and over and over, and their schedule doesn't align with ours. But they expect everyone to be there.
Yeah.
Come on, guys.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's got to be some more give from their side. And, like, I have people say, well, why don't we just push our series back? Because no promoter wants to have an event after school's back in session. You know what I mean? Like, your crowd's going to just plummet.
And all
Redbud's not giving up the 4th of July. You know, the weekend that has Labor Day, they're not giving that up. Like, there's certain weekends these people have locked in.
In the U.S., you got motocross, you got supercross, and that's not going to change. You know, if you push the series back, you're essentially cutting into the supercross time. You're going to have a lot of resistance from promoters, teams, sponsors, whatever it may be.
Well, like you said, these guys hardly get a break anyway. And it's like, what? Now, it doesn't even matter where you put that. It's still, there's less of a break for them.
From that perspective alone, it really should be on the FIM to change that schedule because they have a huge break. They've got plenty of time. Shift it around a little bit. Give us.
They used to have
it
like 2 weeks after our last national. Yeah. For a while, it was 2 weeks. So you had a weekend off to catch your breath, but you were usually packing to go there. So it worked out quite nicely. And then, but now they pretty much dump it right before Monster Cup.
Yeah. It ain't going to work. If they keep doing that, our guys will continue to say no. And I back them.
No, I'm right up there with you.
Back them. If you don't, I mean, I get it. Unless you really want to go and it's something you've always wanted to do or whatever, from a business perspective,
well,
I 100% get it.
Maybe I'm just venting a little bit, but I also remember when at donations, it might have even been 07, the FIM were like, we're going to make the schedule of donations, you know, a little more favorable. And they said something like a four-year rotation. So it'd be like America, Europe, somewhere else in the world, Europe.
Yeah.
And then we'd kind of recycle. So, you know, every 4 years, somewhere like Australia or South Africa or Brazil could have a motocross of nations. America would have one in there as well, and then two in Europe. And I'm like, I think that's pretty fair.
Yeah, that sounds
good. It's gone back to...
They've not done.
We're going to go to France, we're going to go to Italy, we're going to go to England. And we're going to go to France, we're going to go to Italy, we're going to go to England.
Well...
Sometimes they change it up and they go to England, then France.
Oh, that's right. Okay, my bad.
So they do switch it, GL. You're being really one-sided here.
Yeah, you can tell.
Yeah.
All right, so after a year, you had 09 at Honda, and then you left, went to Valley.
Yeah,
Valley
that was, I mean, luckily I had 2 years on my deal. That was, the economy took a crap, you know, like during that time.
Yeah.
So by the end of my contract, 09, like I was obviously trying to get something going for 10, but there was no money anywhere. Like,
yeah.
I couldn't find anything, and that Valley Yamaha deal, Chad Lanza, he approached me about doing something. And I remember the first offer he gave me, I laughed at it. I was like, it was like a 90% pay cut of what I was making before. And of course, you're like, yeah, right. I ended up signing that deal. I mean, I remember trying for a couple of weeks, you know, but time was running out. I'm like, okay, if you want a race, here's your deal.
Yeah.
So I signed it, you know, whatever. But that was probably one of the most fun years of my career.
Was it?
Yeah, I had fun that year. You know, me and Frankie Latham, he was my mechanic at Honda. He left Honda to go to Valley with me.
Which was, that's commitment.
Yeah, it was commitment. And he, if I wouldn't have had him, it wouldn't have worked. But, yeah. You know, he took the role of just doing everything. And my bike was pretty good. I had Bones and Mitch helping me on the bike. And I was a privateer. But, dude, I was doing pretty well that year. Until I got hurt at St. Louis and about died. But
yeah. Big one?
Yeah, it was a big one.
Oh, I remember that now.
Like, I almost died.
I don't remember, really?
It was the same jump Bill Cotto
crashed
on. Oh,
this is when you punctured your lung, right?
Yeah.
I remember that.
You had more internal injuries than that, didn't you?
No, that was it. But it was lap 19 of the main. So, and I was pushing it. I was in fourth. I think third was pretty close to me. So I was really pushing it. My heart rate was probably over 200. And I had a crash, you know, where I just got crunched and crushed 9 ribs and punctured my lungs, and dude, I couldn't breathe. You know, I had a 200 heart rate. I remember sitting there.
That's the worst feeling.
Vision was going out. I couldn't catch a breath. I, in my head, I was like, "All right, dude, this is it. Like, it's done. Like, I'm dying." And the oxygen tank they had was with Villopoto because he had broken his leg real bad. So the oxygen, they didn't have oxygen.
Finally,
it took them a little bit. They got the oxygen on me. Like, I think I would have died if they wouldn't have got that on me. Like, where I was at.
Wow.
And then they finally got me to the hospital, got a chest tube in me, and then it was like a relief. And I remember telling the doctor, "Dude, I felt like I was dying." He's like, "Yeah, you were right there." that was a rough night.
Brutal. That's not good when a doctor says, "Yeah, you're right there." Yeah. You're like, "Oh, I thought I was just thinking I was dying. You're telling me I was dying."
Yeah, you were hoping he was going to say, "No, man, it just feels like you're dying."
Yeah, you're good. You're all right. You're not dying. No, you're dying.
So, did you race nationals that year too? Then
I tried. Well, it took me a while to recover from that. I went to Millville. I showed up. I shouldn't have.
Too soon.
Yeah, I think too soon. I didn't do much testing on the bike, and yeah, I basically like I think I pulled off the first moto and just went home. Like, didn't ride anymore.
This was a bad idea, guys.
Yeah, basically,
I've made a huge mistake.
I think we've all done that before. You think you're?
So I just wanted to fly so I could keep my my status on the airline. I need to get a few more miles in. So.
All right, so the following year, you didn't stay there. You went to Hart and Huntington.
Yeah, did the Hart and Huntington Supercross only deal.
Okay, and this K-Dub's back managing that team.
Yeah.
So now you're back with your buddy K-Dub.
He started that a few years before that, I think, with some other dudes.
Were they still smoke machines and dancing girls, or was it?
Yeah, they were. It was still that, but they were trying to kind of step up their game, I feel.
Hondas at that time or Cowies?
It was Cowies. Okay. It was Cowies. Okay. So,
that's right.
We had Mitch doing the bikes. You know, okay, our bikes were pretty good. I think in 11, our bikes were actually really good. It was me and Blos on the team. And I know Bones really helped me out. We've always had a good relationship. And
yeah.
My bike was pretty good that year. And the following year, they hired Hanny, Partridge, and Hill, and myself. There was 4 guys. I don't know. Something happened between those 2 years. So that bike sucked that year.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what happened.
Mitch Pro Circuit wasn't helping still?
They were, but I don't know if we were getting different components or I'm not sure.
Yeah,
I really don't know. But
the bike was not great.
It wasn't that good that year.
So, not a couple of great seasons. What were you doing all summer?
Just hanging out.
Yeah,
yeah.
Just taking it off.
Yeah, and I was getting older by that point. You know, I
kind of saw the writing on the
wall. Yeah, I knew I wasn't a contender anymore. I was just kind of, you know, doing Supercross only. I knew if I did Supercross and outdoors, I'd only have a few more years left. So I tried to kind of prolong my career, which I did a little bit, but by that point it was starting to be not fun, not doing good. And
yeah, you know, when you're not, the, if you if you want to be top five or whatever your goal is and you're not hitting it, it's not fun.
Really isn't.
Yeah.
Because I was still putting the same amount of work in. You know, you're still putting the same amount of work in, but that makes the work start to be harder to do. You know, when your results aren't
And you don't
there.
Get the reward at the end of it.
It just slowly goes downhill and, you know.
Yeah. So did Hart ever take you guys out and have any big parties or anything that year? Anything you remember from that season?
Not really, man. No. Like, we had a good time. I mean, obviously, me and K-Dub are boys, and it was a good environment, you know. Just it was real low-key, and we had good times those years.
Did Frankie go there with you?
No, that's when he
Berluti was with you.
Yeah, Berluti. Okay. Yeah, yeah. So
the old cat burglar, Berluti.
Yeah, Frankie went on to work for Marvin over
that year. Okay. Yeah. God, he's been with him for a while. Yeah. I worked with Frankie at Plano Honda one summer.
Did you?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. The year I filled in after in 02.
Oh. Yeah. That's right. I forgot he worked over there.
Yeah, with Elliot. And
was that Shark Energy?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
That was when I left team. Or something, after I left?
Yeah. It was the same.
Must have been.
Was your first year at YOT. Okay.
I was filling in for Sheik because he had gotten hurt.
That's what it was.
And that was when Casey Johnson was there and Elliot and somebody else.
Yeah, it was 02, wasn't it? Mm-hmm. 02, oh, yeah.
Yeah, anyway.
It gets a little hard as you get older to remember exactly which years. Well, they start blending.
It's been a long time now.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, that's 17 years
ago. We're old
ago.
As hell.
Yeah.
Okay, so you raced a few more years. What those last few years, what were you doing? Just sort
of? Yeah, like 13, I didn't race at all. I tried to get something going. That was when Hart and Huntington, they went RCH. Ricky came on board. You know, I kind of got pushed out, whatever. But I didn't race in 13. You know, I tried to get something going. And then in 14, I got the call. Millsaps was hurt, and that Rockstar KTM team hit me up. Okay. So I raced in 14, Supercross. But by that point, in 13, I didn't ride at all. I didn't ride for a whole year. So I probably should have
been hard,
out
there. That's hard, right? Like, to not ride at all.
Well, you think, oh, it'll come back, like riding a bicycle. But I think once you've had that time away, everyone else has progressed and you've regressed.
It's like, it's what does make me feel bad about Tickle and what he went through. It's like, I would say he had a couple of years still left in him, but I don't know. You can take a year off without racing.
It's tough. It is.
The only good thing that he's done is seems like he just hasn't stopped riding at all.
Yeah.
He looks really good.
Me that year, I didn't do anything. I was kind of bitter, like, oh, no one wants, you know, I was going through that phase of that, and I didn't do anything in 13, which, if I wanted to keep racing, I probably should have, but the mindset I was in, I was like, screw that. I'm not training for no reason.
So those years didn't go good. Did you just 1 year with them filling in at KTM?
Yeah, I did Supercross with them, and then that's when RCH, I rode outdoors for RCH.
Okay.
And then that's when I started testing for them. I kind of knew I was at the end. They approached me about riding outdoors for them and start doing their testing.
Yeah, I remember that.
So I figure, okay, let's do this, and it'll open up the door. I retired at Bud's Creek, actually. Overheated at Bud's Creek. That's when I retired.
Right there.
That summer, yeah.
What was it about that race?
I don't know. I mean, it was hot that day.
You just went, you know what? I don't have to do this shit anymore.
That was the other time. I almost died. Like, it was hot that day. The motos are pretty quick turnaround. I must have not been hydrated enough. Like, the last lap, like, I looked at my heart rate data. It kept climbing, like, 200. I got up to, like, 208.
Jeez.
I fell in one of those off cambers, and I was sitting there trying to start my bike, and it spiked all the way to 214. That's when I took my helmet off, and I finished the race without a helmet.
Oh.
Because I didn't even know what I was doing. I was so – and I don't know if you know Bud's Creek. Like, it's – you're kind of – once you're on the track, you can't go straight to the pits. Yeah. It's fenced in all the way, so I remember thinking, like, I'm dying right now. Like, I'm going to die. And I rode without a helmet, finished the moto, and I went back to the truck.
Just like the rest of that lap?
Yeah, that half a lap. It was from that tight off camber to the finish.
When you drop down and do the...
Yeah.
Okay.
And I remember I got back to the truck just thinking, I got to get to ice water, you know, like, cool off. And the AMA truck, the AMA guys come over there screaming, what the hell are you doing? You know, because I was racing with no helmet on. Like, don't worry about it, dude. Like, that's the last time you'll ever see me race. I retire. Like,
you know what? I quit.
Yeah, you can take my points away. You can penalize me next. You can do whatever. Yeah.
So I quit there on the spot. That's how I retired from racing.
Wow. I didn't know
that. And then that's when I moved on to start doing their testing and development. I did that for 2 years over there for RCH with Roxen, helped those guys out. And then I hurt my – I had a bad heel injury.
Oh, yeah.
That Red Bull straight rhythm. Had this winter, because I was doing their supercross testing for them, and I was riding pretty well. They were like, hey, let's go do the straight rhythm just for fun. You know, so went and did it and had a bike shut off on me in one of the biggest jumps and shattered my heel. And
did you jump off?
Yeah, I had to jump through the handlebars. Yeah,
I remember hearing about it. I didn't see it.
That was a bad one. I was hobbling around for about a year and a half before I could walk right. And those were some rough years for me, for sure.
Yeah. We always talk about that time when you decide to retire, how tough that is for racers, like going, okay, what now?
And
like,
when is the right time?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I feel like they're all saying you need to let the dream go, but it's what we know to do. And at some point, even if you're like, maybe I'm not going to win, but I'm getting a decent living doing something that I love. And then down the road, sometimes you're like, did I hang in too long? Should I have done this? Like you said, should I have stayed riding when I didn't have a deal? Like, I think everyone struggles a little bit with that to an extent.
How was it for you?
That was a struggle, especially I was okay while I was doing the testing, but then when I got hurt and then like I had nothing to do and I was, dude, I struggled, you know, waking up with nothing, like a goal to go do this or do that. Yeah. Like, that's tough for sure.
Yeah. So then you got into testing with Mitch.
Yeah. And that deal came up. I kind of got my ankle good enough by that point, and I hadn't rode since then. It was maybe a couple times, and we started talking about doing a deal, and I hadn't rode supercross in a long time. I remember going to the supercross track for the first day. I was so nervous, like, dude, how am I going to do this right now? But I was a little rusty, but after a few days, I was fine. And
are you still doing supercross?
Yeah,
testing?
Yeah, still. The last 2 years, I've done all their development on their bike, and still out there with the boys.
God, doesn't it get sketchy? Like, I rode supercross for like maybe 5 years after I quit with the TLD guys just for fun. I'd go out with them once in a while. And then I had a couple of like moments and I'm like, what am I doing?
I haven't been on a supercross track in a long time. Yeah. And now I'm at that point where I'm like, yeah, no, I'm good.
No, you don't want to get
like fun for you guys.
You don't want to get back
like
into
the first few days. I just had to get that feel back. You know, once I got it back, I was fine.
Yeah.
But if this year when I think I'm going to do the testing again. Like, it'll be a little rusty at first, but
I'm always impressed at Jeremy. He's got to be close to 50 now, and he'll just jump
he'll
out.
He'll still rip out.
Just whoops, bop, 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 no problem. Like, it must just come so naturally to him.
But I still enjoy it. I enjoy the testing process and enjoy trying to make bikes better. You know, that's one of the things I like to do. So I'm going to do it as long as my body will let me, you know, like.
Yeah. Well, and those guys, Bones and the Pro Circuit guys, they say you're like one of the best testers they've ever had. Your feel for little changes is so good.
Yeah. And I think it's that. And it's a lot of, I've had to learn. I've had to kind of teach myself on that end, too. It's all about communication.
Yeah.
Oh, am I pulling that up?
Yeah, you're.
Uh-oh.
Don't pull.
What do we got?
Am I good? Am I good?
Yeah, you're good.
I heard something. But it's just all about communication, right?
Yeah.
You can feel it, but if you can't communicate it to the technicians, it's.
Yeah, and you also have to know what those changes do. Like,
yeah,
you know, if you open up high speed, what does that do? How does that affect the bike? What am I trying to get to? It takes some time.
No, it does. But like for me, like I focus, like as a racer, you know, you shouldn't have to focus on that. You just should focus about going fast, right?
Yeah. Do you like this or this?
Were you sensitive
this or this?
Were you sensitive or picky as a rider? Like,
I always was, and they didn't always listen to me. You know, that's the other thing. You know, like. The only thing way things get better is if you listen, I guess.
Yeah.
It's got to be a two-way street. You got to be able to communicate, and they got to be able to give you what you need after that.
And then how did the deal with Marchbanks come about? Just you were testing with them, and he needed some help. And
just being testing with the PC guys. And
yeah.
I kind of wanted to jump into that, you know, doing some coaching and stuff, and the opportunity came about. And I'm enjoying that side, too.
Are you?
Yeah. Just like anything, though, it's been a learning process, you know, just like anything. Just learning how to communicate, and just like everything, it's all about communication.
When those guys come in, a lot of them, it's like they need somebody like you that understands how to completely round out a program, right? Like, okay, maybe he's doing the right things on the bike, but what about off the bike? What are you eating? Are you drinking the right things? Are you getting enough sleep? Are you, you know what I mean? There's all those little components that come in.
Well, even when they have questions, just someone that they know that's been there that they can truly believe in their opinion.
And I think we all had somebody, you know, I'm sure you had somebody, like you have to have somebody that you rely on, that you can lean on, you know, you can't do it by yourself.
Yeah. You and Nick Way throw elbows on the side of the track?
No, that's good. Actually, it's been good hanging with Nick. You know, he's been out there with AC, and, you know, it's good.
Yeah, that's funny. I forgot you guys are out there together.
Yeah, we've spent quite a bit of time out at the tracks together.
Do you ever talk? I always like what GL says about, you know, kind of teaching somebody how to handle losses, how to handle losing, how to handle an injury, just a bad performance. Do you guys ever talk about that?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, like Garrett, he's...
Well, I'm sure he's probably a little disappointed at some of his results. So I'm sure you've had that conversation.
It's been a struggle this year for him, you know, but it's been a lot of the typical rookie struggles, I feel, you know.
And yeah.
From this point, I feel like it's kind of a breaking point for him, whether he goes up or down. You know?
He needs a confidence booster at this point is what he needs.
Like, really, he needs this weekend to end it on a good note to go into the off season, and, you know, yeah. He really needs that bad.
Yeah. Is he mentally just kind of beat up?
Yeah, I think anybody that, you know, you're not doing as good as you feel you should be, and, you know, everybody around you is like, dude, what's going on? And we know you're better than this. You know, he knows
it doesn't
better.
Help that his teammate's been sort of dominating the series, because that takes any excuse.
But the kid's talented. He's definitely got the talent and potential to do it. It's just, you know, it's try to get it out of him, you know.
Yeah.
It's like a puzzle trying to piece it together, right? Yeah.
Is that ever frustrating for you, going, okay, guy, I see this kid doing it during the week.
Yeah.
What do we need to – how do I help him get his head right?
For sure. Like, I'm sure people were like that with me in the past, you know. Like, dude, why are you so good on Tuesday but you suck on Saturday?
Yeah.
You know, but not being so black and white with it, but, like, the kid has been really good during the week and hasn't quite brought that on a Saturday yet, but he will. He will eventually.
It's like – it can just be a start. It can be just one moto, and then everything's different.
Often it's a start that leads to running good laps up front, which leads to, if not winning, a solid moto, and it's like, oh, I can actually do it. I do belong
up there.
What's funny is he seemed to have a better year in Supercross. I mean, he ran up front in a lot of Supercrosses, and he's been almost non-existent in outdoors.
Yeah,
you'd think it'd be the opposite.
Yeah.
Well, I haven't studied all of his starts, but generally speaking, he's not been near the front in most of the starts, so... And that class is so – there's so much depth, in my opinion, where you got a lot of fast guys. To come from 20th,
you can get
to 15th, but it's not like – I feel like a long time ago when there wasn't maybe as much depth, you could go from 20th to 8th or 20th to 7th. It's hard to do that now. You can start 10th and stay 10th.
There's
legitimately
15 fast guys there.
Well, by the time you get yourself in position, say in 10th, the leaders are gone.
Yeah.
You know, like – they're 30 seconds out already, you know, by the time you even get in position. Like,
well, here's a good way to think of it, too. There's basically six factory teams in that class, six manufacturers, with roughly four riders, except for Husky. I think they have one less, but Honda's got like 19 riders under their truck. So you've got almost 30 factory guys.
Yeah.
There's a lot of depth.
You can be in the battle of your life with a legit dude for 20th.
Yeah.
You're like, I just want to get a point, bro.
Let me have it, you son of a bitch.
Yeah.
I got bills to pay. Can I get bonus for 19th?
Yeah, right.
You start asking the teams.
I've been there before, like battling for 20th. It's not a good feeling, right?
No.
And you don't even want to look at your pit board. No. Like, don't show me I'm 20th.
Yeah. Like, that was one where Southwick would just kick me in the balls.
Yeah.
I'm in just a death match with a guy I've never heard of, you know? Like, if it's Dowdy or Casey Johnson, I'm like, okay.
Yeah.
But it's like, you know.
What about that feeling? You're like,
Patrick Potato.
You're like, I'm dying. Got to be getting the two-lap card, and you get the halfway sign. You're like, no, there's no way.
Yeah. Oh, this flagger just dicked it up. He meant to put out the two laps to go.
Yeah.
I see you're going back to Farley this year.
Yeah, I'm going.
Wob's posted some pictures of your bike. I'm like, oh.
I'm going to ride the 92 YZ250 this year.
Nice.
Okay.
At least I'm not on a 500.
Are you on? Oh, so you're not on a 500?
No,
okay.
No. That was, man.
So you got to tell
like
us.
I had never rode a 500 before.
I was
like,
the same way.
It's a dirt bike. Like, I'll be fine, dude. Like, right? But like four laps of practice, go rip this thing. Dude, that's scary.
And it's
like,
timed. There was a lot of things about Farley. I don't know if you.
I went there.
I know, but I don't know if you caught this same thing. But like when I showed up, they're like, yeah, you get four laps of practice.
Yeah.
Oh, and those are timed, and that's going to be your start pick for the whole weekend.
Yeah, but I'll throw that in.
And there's 60 gates, right? You could be
they have an extension at the end of their 40 gates. You're like, what the hell? They're like, oh, yeah, it's a big class. I'm like, no shit. Well, I had never ridden the bike either that I ended up riding. It was just there.
Which was what?
KX500.
Okay. Oh, you did ride one.
And
it was
pissing rain. And I'm like, sweet. Two-stroke, 500.
Yeah.
On a choppy, rocky, muddy
it's
thing.
Grass.
This is made for me. This event. I'm like, it's everything I'm not meant to do. And it was. I had the worst arm pump ever.
Oh,
I was like freaking whiskey throttling everywhere.
Not to mention that guy went perpendicular in the track in front of you.
It was probably the best thing that happened though, because after that, I sprained my wrist. And I was like, oh, I'd love to ride, but I can't.
All right, so you got to tell us, walk him through what happened the first few motos last year there.
Oh, on the twin shock?
Yeah,
oh,
so he's dude. On the... He's so on the team, right? I just went as a media guy. Oh, gotcha, I rode a 125 with the Evo class or whatever it was.
So you were teammates with Dubok, and I, Audi. Yeah, exactly.
I wasn't told that everyone was riding. I thought I was going to be in a 125 class. They're like, oh, no, it's mostly 500s. There's a couple 250s. I think there's one other guy.
They're like, where should I line up? They're like, it doesn't fucking matter. You may as well face backwards. Yeah, you'll come out in the same spot.
So anyway.
I was riding, what was it, 500? It's a Husky 500 four-stroke, the twin-shock.
Twin-shock.
I think it was 81 or something. And the
That's not the bike MX rode a few years ago, is it?
I don't know.
I just remember MX said it was horrible.
It was a left Kickstarter. I couldn't start the bike to save my life. No, there was only one dude on the team that could start it.
That's your first sign you shouldn't be riding.
Yeah, they'd started in staging, and then you ride up to the gate and drop in. The first moto, I'm like, all right, sitting there, and I accidentally hit the kill switch. I'm like, oh, shit. I'm sitting there trying to kill it. It's pointless. Like, I'm not starting this thing. So I had to push
it. And you can't get help, right?
No, you can't get help. So I had to wait till the gate dropped, push it around to the mechanics area, and then have the dude start it and then go. Whatever. That was
a wash that moto. Okay.
We're going to throw that score away,
yeah,
guys.
Yeah, so the second moto, I'm sitting there. I'm like, all right, dude, don't touch nothing. Just
just keep it idling.
Dude, then somehow my foot hits the shifter and it
puts it
stalls
in gear.
I'm like, there's no way that just happened. Like,
you just start running.
So of course, I'm sitting there trying to kick it, but it was impossible. So I do the same thing. Run the bike over to the mechanics area, have them start it. Like, and the whole team, it's for Team USA, right? It's not just a...
And the Europeans are like, this guy's got a real weird ritual.
And looking and like, at me like, dude, are you serious right now? Like, you can't just...
This dude can't start.
So they threw away those two motos. Like, you throw away... There's four guys per team. They throw away one moto per moto. One score per moto, if that makes sense. So they threw my score away, both of those, and luckily they had
and
good
dude,
motos.
I don't know how it was when you were there. Dowdy, like his wife Trish, they take it seriously. She's up there like doing all the scoring, and like it was real motocross.
Way more intense than I was expecting. Like, yeah. I was like thinking, okay, this is a fun vet race. Like, I show up there, they're like, no, dude, we're here to win.
Dubok, you know, and like, Nicole, Kurt and Nicole are in a battle, duel to the death for their championship class, you know, their class. Yeah. Brownie, he's, you know.
Yeah.
Just
Brownie
in it
rips that
gnarly,
guy, yeah.
So what then? What I thought on one of the classes, the KX500, you stalled in the first turn too, right, or something?
No, the forks
are
broke.
Okay.
So we did a hot lap, and like all of a sudden, like my front end just feels like super low. I'm like, dude, something's wrong. Like I, you know, like pull it up like a foot. Like one of the fork springs broke, I think.
Okay.
And before the motor, like we had to like. I had to go race because it was for the designations. Where they're like, oh, just go race it. Go race it. It'll be fine. Like, I'm like, okay.
With a fork swing on a KX500.
But, dude, I ended up, the thing was better in some area, like corner, like because it had more weight on the front. Like, I was ripping on the thing. Like,
they're like, don't worry, we'll fix it off the motor. You're like, you know what?
No,
actually,
just leave
we're
it.
Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, you kind of disappeared for a while. And then when I started catching up with you with what was going on and I heard the stories, I started watching. And you were hauling ass.
Yeah, once I.
You got it figured out.
I was like, I kind of, because I think it was going to break and I was just going to endo.
Yeah.
And once I just kind of shut my brain off, the thing was ripping.
So funny, dude.
What about in the other moto in the 500 class?
It's arm pump. I had arm pump every moto.
Yeah.
Arm pump.
Those bikes are arm pump producing.
Dude, well, it's the track. It's like,
because you go up the hill and you
wide
hold up
open,
a DLI.
High speed, and just chatter everywhere. Not a smooth line on that thing.
You get arm pump on anything.
It was pissing rain. Like pissing rain.
Yeah, we got really lucky.
Yeah.
You're going to get rained on this year.
Oh, I know.
Yeah.
I know. I'm great in the mud, though.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
We all are.
all three of us.
We just keep telling ourselves that. Yeah.
So what else you got planned for the future? What's Ivan Tedesco going to do in 2 years, 10 years?
Right
in
now?
10 years, going to be battling with Kurt Nickel and Doug Dubok.
Yeah, still.
I don't know, man. I'm just kind of taking it as it comes, like doing the testing thing till that runs out. Obviously, can't do that forever.
Yeah.
And then, I'm enjoying doing the coaching, training. I enjoy doing that, being around the races again. And, you know, I feel like that's what I'm here to do. You know, so I feel like I'm around the sport as long as it'll take me.
You don't mind the travel still and stuff like that?
I don't mind it. I'm sure that'll – because I do have two boys at home. I don't want to spend too much time away from them. But, you know, try to balance that. And, you know, they're all into ball sports, football and baseball, so doing that whole deal.
And how's that? Because my girls are fully into soccer. So I'm like, I went to my first pro soccer game last weekend.
Oh, you did?
A Galaxy game. It was awesome.
Oh, we have tickets. My son's into it as well, so.
It's fun, dude. Yeah. Like, all the songs are in Spanish. You got to learn another language to really get into it.
No, it's cool. I enjoy it. Any sports, you know. So watching them do their thing, and they're passionate about baseball and ball sports, so.
Yeah. Did you ever put them on a bike?
No, like even when I have moto on TV or this or that, they're like, well, that's cool, but they're not into it.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
I'm not going to push them into it, you know, like whatever you want to do.
How old are they?
They're 10 and 6.
Do they know you're a past champion? I mean.
Yeah, and I think as they're getting older, they're starting to see more and like, yeah, they're starting to realize a little more. But they haven't been around that, the races that much or. They haven't been around it that
Are they
much.
Always wondering what the IT9 stands for? Or?
Yeah.
Well, do your kids ever call you hot sauce?
No.
Hey, hot sauce.
Hey, speaking of that, do you have a giant collection of hot sauce?
Somewhere. They did that magazine deal where a bunch of people shipped in a bunch of hot sauces. Yeah, I have them somewhere.
I remember that.
Did you would you get random hot sauce at the track? Would people bring it to you?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. Anyway. Oh, yeah. Try this one out.
You're like, I'll try it after
like,
the
I don't even like hot sauce.
True, huh?
Wasn't your oldest boy, is it Hunter?
Yeah, Hunter.
Didn't he come to the 125 Dream Race thing at Washougal or something? And it was like the first time he'd really seen you race.
Yeah, yeah.
I thought that was pretty cool.
About 2 years ago. Yeah, he had no clue. Brought him up on the podium with me. And he had a good time.
That's cool. Neat. Yeah, it's fun, I think, to kind of like dive into something else, like baseball or whatever. It's like we didn't get to really do that.
No, I enjoy it, and I do it a lot with him, obviously playing catch and all that. Yeah. So I'm getting better myself.
Yeah, you get your arm down.
No, I laugh because when my son started trying to figure out who dad was, he went to YouTube and the top thing that popped up was me in Daytona when I endowed my brains out right next to you.
Dude, yeah, I seen that.
And he watched it over and over and over and he would tell his friends, look, this is my dad. I'm like, Deb, I actually, I've got to look at my trophy room. I have a couple in there. Yeah. That's not my career right there. But that was all he would ever watch. And I'm like, there's more to it, I promise.
Yeah. Dude, what I'm known for is getting sucked up into the bike on the starting. And people come up to me more on that than anything.
Whose bike was that?
Tevin Tapia's.
That was
gnarly looking. I made Sports Center.
It looked pretty gnarly, but you came out right on
that
one.
Yeah, it didn't even hurt. It was weird.
It was like rubbing your knee brace or something.
It felt like the pressure of the wheel. But
happened to Millsap too, right? Millsap.
I think they have.
Yeah, it happened to
It's happened a few times. It never looked. You just think, no, he's going to be wrecked. And then the guy will pop out and start riding again.
You think they're going to have to sawzall the wheel off to get your leg out of there.
Joel's alive.
What advice would you give to young racers? I mean, I guess you're giving it to Marchbanks, but...
Work hard. There's no substitute for hard work.
That's it.
Like,
it's pretty straightforward.
Yeah, I mean, there really isn't any way around it. If you have the talent to do it and you work hard, you're most likely you're going to be successful. But without the hard work, you're not going to be successful at anything.
There was several fans that kind of asked the question in a various amount of ways, but it was sort of the main thing was, what was your favorite team or period in your pro career?
I would have to say pro circuit, obviously. I mean, obviously I had success. That was the only time when I won my championships, but still being there and being around the team and with Mitch, and that always felt like home to me, you know. Just even after I left Mitch's, when I was at Suzuki, Honda, Valley, I still would always talk with Bones, communicate with them, ask them for advice. That was kind of home for me always.
It seems like, I think anyone, when you look back, anyone that's won a championship pro circuit have always said it's like they've got your back, even if you were a privateer, different team, they'll be there for you. And I think Mitch is just that kind of guy. I moved on, I used to go and hang out there quite a bit. In fact, I'd see you there. There'd be like RC, me, everyone that used to ride for him hanging out at the Nationals that had moved on to other teams.
Well, even if you don't win a championship for him, it's that same
He's still
way.
Nice to you.
<He's still nice. laughs> No, that's a good group of guys. Yeah. I enjoy them.
Yeah, they are. I think everyone that comes through there, especially if you spend multiple years, you just sort of become part of that family. And
but like even just the whole sport feels like family. You know, I was away for a couple of years, then you start coming back around. It's like, dude, it's awesome.
Yeah, it's a neat sport.
There's
neat
always a couple wankers, but generally speaking, most people are pretty cool.
All right, so this is our kicker question. How do you want to be remembered?
Remembered.
I want your legacy.
You don't
want to
be the guy known as getting drugged through the wheel.
Yeah, with my legs.
So you got sucked up into that bike.
Or the guy that got into a scrapping match on the track.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's probably what I'll be known for, being scrappy. Being scrappy and there to, I don't know.
Yeah.
Hard worker, scrappy. Yeah.
I would say so. You're quiet, though. You don't like...
Yeah, I'm not.
You've sort of disappeared. Yeah.
Yeah. That's kind of how I like it, though. I'm not Mr. Social Media. I don't like people knowing what I'm doing. Just, I don't know.
Do your own
thing. This is my thing.
Yeah. Just hiding out in your new house, and I won't even say where it's at.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. If you're looking for Ivan, he's at this address. Anybody you want to thank or anything you want to say to fans out there?
Yeah, thanks to all the fans that have just – I feel like I have a lot of fans that have been there from the beginning. And I love the sport. Still here. Love it.
Cool, man. Well, I appreciate you coming on the show. I consider you a friend. I say GL does too.
And yeah.
We love seeing you around the races still.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Thanks for coming on.
Thanks a bunch.
Good show, dude. Laid back. I like the vibe.
Thanks, we love it.
We need to each come to a live one and have some fun with us.
Okay.
Those are GL gets lean pops going in the show. So,
all right. Four stroke bogs.
Yeah, yeah. I can't ride it. It goes bo-wong.
Bo-wing.
All right. That's our show with Ivan Tedesco. Hang tight. We're going to be right back to wrap up the rest of the Whiskey Throttle Show.
4WP is more than a store. We're truck and Jeep experts. From wheel and tire upgrades to full custom builds, 4WP has you covered. Do your rig right. Shop online or find your store at 4WP.com.
Everybody, welcome back to the Whiskey Throttle Show. It's good times with Ivan Tedesco. What do you think of that?
That was good. I've known Ivan quite a lot. I feel like our timelines were very similar, and we were teammates. And even when he was talking about, when he 05 was in his motorhome, that we were often parked right next to each other, barbecuing, the night before the race together. So nice teammate to have. Just like
no drama,
nah,
easy going.
That's the interesting thing about him is you never ever hear anybody talk bad about him.
It's because he's just very, very chill. You got to really piss him off for him to not like
you. Ever seen
like
him mad? You ever seen him mad?
I have,
yeah.
But it takes a lot.
Yeah.
It takes like standing on his bike in a championship mode.
Yeah. That would upset just about anybody, I think.
It takes a lot.
I forgot to bring it up, but I was going to tell him, hey, sorry if I turned down one of your championship shirts. I was a little salty that day. So after he won the title, they come out with the shirts and they're handing out. And they're like, you want one? I'm like, no.
Yeah, that's tough.
I know.
It's tough for any racer to put on another guy's shirt. But
I think, when it's one of those when you realize afterwards, I probably came across as a real dick.
Yeah.
That's not the first time for you, GL.
No, I know. I do it all the time.
Yeah.
Comes naturally.
He's an awesome dude. We appreciate him coming on. So big thanks to him. And he's brought to you by PowerDot. So let's get into our four-wheel parts Get At Me Q&A. Donnie's got some questions queued up. Four-wheel parts is your one-stop shop for everything off-road. Go in there, check them out. Method Race Wheels. You can have tires and wheels mounted, lift kits, lowering kits, bumpers, winches, lights, steps, anything off road, and they service it, mount it, install it.
And plug in coolers for your van. Don't think I didn't hit them for that.
Plug in coolers, huh?
Yeah, you just plug it in. like the Sprinter has a little cigarette lighter down here, and it comes with an option, but basically it's a cooler that's a fridge.
What the hell?
Now I got my drinks on ice, but I don't drink and drive.
My, my road dog's down here. All right. Anyway, go to 4Wheel Parts, the number 4WheelParts.com. Check those guys out. If you're local here, they've got a shop right off of Winchester and the 15 in Temecula. So.
Well, they have a few around SoCal.
That's the closest one down there where I live, so I'm just going to shout it out. Those guys are awesome, but they're
that's where I
nationwide.
Went. Yeah,
yeah, they're awesome. Check them out. What do we got today, Donnie?
Elliot wants to know, what is the single best piece of advice you guys have received for on the track and off the track while you were racing?
Best piece of advice? Jeez, we got some... should have read these questions beforehand.
Did anybody give you a piece of advice that you know you really carried with you on the track, and then when you weren't racing?
I think every racer sort of has that tough time, and I remember for me, my dad was always there for me. But when I was in Europe, I really struggled. I mean, I didn't qualify for a Grand Prix, and I lost faith in myself. And I think the best piece of advice at that point in time was when Harry Evetts, full-time world champion, father to a 10-time world champion, said to me, believe in yourself. You have something special. Don't give up. You will be a champion one day. And I looked at him and I did one of those tilt my head, roll my eyes. And he said, trust me. Just keep doing what you're doing. Because when things don't go well, they think they got to sort of reinvent the wheel, you know, change everything. He said, just stick with your program and it'll come right. And because at that point in time, I was so lost. So I think it just helped me go, okay, I'm going to believe what he says and just stick with it.
I would say two things. Like the two things that I try to pass along when I get asked questions like that are, first of all, try to keep emotion out of it, right? Yeah. Like a lot of times when you're racing, especially if someone cuts you off or you're in a battle with somebody, you can let emotion start to dictate the way you ride.
And then it can affect your results.
It totally affects your results.
Does.
And it'll
That's a
affect,
good one.
It'll even affect your heart rate because your heart rate will jump up. You start, you know. So you have to just focus on what you're doing out there. Don't let emotion get into it. And that's easier said than done. I get it. I was terrible at that. But it was something I worked on. And the other thing is focus on what you can change. I used to stress out so bad.
So this is off-the-track advice?
It could be really – it's mostly off the track. But, yeah, but even on the track, like, I would stress out about shit that I couldn't control.
Yeah.
I had no control over it. And yet I would just, like, I would let it eat me up until I was so balled up I couldn't – you know, walk through the pits, let alone ride. Focus on the things you can change. Okay. That's really you, right? Your diet, your exercise, your riding, your whatever. You can't change the things you can't change. So why worry about them?
Yeah.
You know,
that was a little bit what I was going to say was the off the track thing was, I think I had family and people around me that had that attitude because you know how it is. You have a bad day and it can linger for a while. And I remember, I think one day my dad said to me, listen, if there's footage or whatever, go watch, go learn from your mistake. Put it behind. You can't change your result, can't change what happened, but now what you can change is making sure you don't ever do that again or that again or screw that up or learn from that. You got to learn. So it was kind of like trying not to live with regrets, but take any failure as a learning opportunity to build from.
I preach that to my kids all the time after a soccer match if they lose. I'm like, all right, well, what did we learn today? What how could you be better? What mistakes did you make?
We sucked, Daddy.
Well, you know, I try to just get them to think it through and go, well, okay, I could have done this better. You know, this happened. Maybe if I'd have done this, you know, and you just get them to think about it.
Yeah.
And then it's like, you know, it's kind of that cliche old saying, I don't lose, I either win or I learn.
Yeah.
But you need to take something from that. Like, really, don't let a defeat just destroy you. Figure out what you can learn from it. How do I not let that happen again? And
hey, on a side note, do you see any soccer parents get like heated and things?
Oh my god, many parents
have
nothing on soccer parents.
No, they
You've
get excited.
Never seen that. People thrown out of the games every weekend.
Fist fights,
damn near.
Really?
Going out screaming at the refs, and the refs just like you're gone. And the ref, he'll just stand there and hold the ball until the parents gone off the field.
We had that at one game.
It's wild.
Had to be, I was like, wow. I was just sitting back going, this is pretty interesting. I get into it a little bit. But I only kind of yell at my own kids. You know what I mean?
I'm like, what are you doing?
Yeah. Well, here's the thing is it's like you're not really helping, right? Like most of the time.
Yeah.
99% of the time, whatever you're screaming at them, It's like someone on the side of the track going, go!
Yeah.
I'm trying. No shit.
Thank you.
It's what I'm doing.
Thank you, doctor. Appreciate the advice.
No, so. I would, with Devin, sometimes, if say he missed the ball or made a little mistake, he would turn and look at me, and then someone would fumble the ball and it'd be rolling up behind his legs, and I'm like, focus on the freaking game, man.
Oh, Dad, I screwed up. What do I do?
There's a ball someplace on the field.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's funny. All right, what else you got?
Now that we're done with kids soccer.
Junkman wants to know, what's a typical top pro's training week consist of?
It changes.
Yeah.
You know, your off-season training, I mean, whether you're in supercross or outdoors, obviously the tracks you ride, the length of time, the testing, the preparation changes. But I think if you were just to keep it, you know, a little generic, everyone does things differently. We were talking about it, you know, like Ivan said, not everyone can fit into Ricky's program. And I had to also learn what worked for me. For me, what really worked, especially when I was still learning and developing in supercross, was a lot of bike time. So I rode a lot during the week around those years. I didn't do a ton of off-the-bike trainings. I was predominantly bike training, but with enough of that, I built up mass. You know, I got my strength from being on the bike, whereas other riders have a smaller build, so they have to go to the gym or whatever. But I rode a lot. I usually typically would try and ride sometimes Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday,
yeah,
and then go to the races. But then during the season, once I felt I was at that point where you're just more maintaining, there were times I'd go Tuesday, or, you know, light bicycle ride Tuesday, Monday, ride Tuesday, maybe do nothing or swim during the summer or something light, and then ride Thursday. So I'd always tone it down during the season. And it was funny because people always talk about what you put in is what you get out. A lot of times when I toned down my training during the outdoors, the results got a little bit better. But like I said to people, you build that base and you get to a point that if you keep running yourself in the ground, you start burning out and go the wrong direction. Yeah. So for me, it was a lot of riding.
Yeah, and I probably tried to do a little bit more of a mix of it, especially in the summer. I enjoyed riding supercross, and I would go, even if I wasn't doing motos, I would try to stay on the bike 3-4 times a week.
Yeah.
But like you said, outdoors, I would get to a point where I'm just like, I'd be halfway through a motor, and I'd just be like, I don't even want to be out here, you know? It's Glen Helen, it sucks, it's hot, like, what am I doing? And to be fair, I wasn't having great results when my attitude was like that.
Because I've had that attitude before, but at least when, if you're winning or fighting for the win, you're like, it sucked, but
I gotta do it, yeah.
We got a W out of that one.
Do you guys feel like we've shifted too far to too much off-the-bike training, all this off-the-bike stuff?
Personally, I think so at times, especially with some younger kids that need to be developing their skills.
I think there's a place for it. There's a place for it. But, yeah, we've turned guys into Tour de France contenders. And
I mean, Lance Armstrong didn't go jumping his dirt bike 3 days a week when he was doing the tour. He freaking pedaled, you know. So I still truly believe, like you said, don't lose sight of, there is no substitution for seat time. Every time you ride, you learn how your bike handles, where it's good, where it's not, where you could be better. You'll always learn a little something. And like I said, the more you ride, the more you and your bike become one. Mm-hmm. Even if it's not great, the more you ride it, the more you get used to it, and the better you will work together.
I noticed that's a common thread, too, all these champions that come through. You hear that from them. I just rode a lot. You know, from Marty Smith and on, even these guys are doing, they focused on the bike. That's kind of a common thread with all the champions.
And even scheduling playtime on the bike in there.
Totally. Yeah.
Not just making
that's
it about
something
work.
I think needs to not be a part of your program, but I still think there's guys that they train and they ride and they're trying so hard, and then it's almost like you need to say to them, you know what, instead of going to the track, go to the hills and just go have fun and enjoy your bike and get that passion back.
Yeah.
I did that once or twice. I remember once at KTM I was getting really despondent and burned out, and Larry Brooks said, just don't go to the track, go to the hills, just go have fun, go screw around. And it was really good because I came back and I was like, yeah, I feel like I want to race, you know.
I did that once or twice for like 2 or 3 years at a time. No, I did the work too. All right, what else we got?
Our Aussie buddy Brett Jones wants to know, what's your favorite SoCal track to ride today? Like,
first of all, Brett, we need more Tim Tams, and I can't answer any questions.
He did ask that. He asked.
He says P.S., which I was going to get to.
Do you need more
Tim Tams?
More Tim Tams.
No, I just had some Aussie friends, Pete and Desiree, and they literally came with like shipping boxes.
Of Tim Tams?
Yeah, and all other kinds of
stuff.
You
got them at your house there? Because I'm going to stop by.
Please do, because it's really, I open the fridge, and I'm like, oh, I'll just have one or two, and then I'll stop by and I'm like, I just polished a pack in
I'll
a day and a half.
I'll stop by and pick up some Tim Tams.
Actually, please do. I need them gone because I have no self-control.
To get back to this question, I would say my favorite track is Kauia Creek. In the winter especially, but I would say even all year, it's probably the best track as far as just being fun to ride, fun layout, great dirt.
I agree. Since they redid the track a little bit, bring some of that dirt back on that got washed off because it's kind of on a hill if you haven't been there. Since they brought some of that topsoil back on, it's really fun to ride.
Yeah. It's.
Have you guys ever ridden the trails back there? Those trails are fun back there too.
Really fun.
Yeah, we did it when KTM had an off-road launch the one day and all the dealers could bring their customers. I rode, I think, every single bike they manufactured.
Did you ride across that telephone pole bridge?
I believe so.
Yeah. Dude, I would ride across that thing.
You want to do it?
Oh, dude, I look like I'm going to just... I did it once, and I thought, oh, I'm going to die.
It's got a little... It's two of them actually together, so there's a rut.
Yeah.
There's a rut, and then the bike like will pull from one side to the other if you're not going fast enough, which is my problem entirely.
It teaches you balance.
Yeah.
It taught me that I don't want to fall off that bridge.
Well, I would make Kauia Creek definitely a stop on your tour if you're coming to the U.S. to ride a little bit or just coming to Southern Cal.
That's funny because a lot of those vacation destination places that are here, they all make sure they go to Kauia Creek.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I think it's a safety net because you got riders from all around the world that are coming for an experience that want to have a fun track to ride, and you got guys that are maybe a C-grade rider and a guy that's a wannabe superstar. Kauia is actually a pretty good place to go because I think it's – there's no massive technical jumps, and there's a couple. There's always been like that one big jump in the back, but you can just go step up and over the tabletop, and the good guys go all the way over. So they've tailored the track to where less experienced guys can have fun and more experienced guys can have fun.
It's truly, it looks like a vet national because every fast former rider, when you go there on a Wednesday, is always there.
Yeah. Well, and they have a vet track, and they have a kids track, and they have all those trails. So there's quite a bit. You know, they cover something for everybody.
That's all I got.
That's all we got. That's our four-wheel parts. Get at me Q&A. You send questions. We answer them. Keep those coming for any and all shows. Our Decal Works last call. If you guys have not been to Decal Works for any of your graphic needs, check them out, decalworks.com. And they make a lot of things, seat covers, floor mats, all kinds of ID kits, anything that has adhesive on it, they pretty much make it. Mm-hmm. Nipple tape? I don't know if they make that. They make a lot of good stuff, and they do the graphics for the Red Bull KTM team. You can order Whiskey Throttle Show graphics there, so go over there and check those guys out. They give away tickets, 5 tickets every live show as well, so we'll be doing that before our September 13th show. In this installment of the Decal Works Last Call, we got a hold of Kenny Watson. And K-Dub, if you are not familiar with him, managed, as Ivan said, they were really good friends. He was managing the Plano Honda team when they hired Ivan. Then when he went over to Hart and Huntington, was managing that team, he brought Ivan there. So he's been around the industry for a long time. He's had a lot of ups and downs. But we're going to catch up with him and get his thoughts on Ivan Tedesco. So have a listen.
K-Dub.
Yes, sir.
Hey, buddy. It's Ping. Thanks for taking the call, man.
Who?
Oh, David Pingree. Yeah, we used to know each other way back in 94 when we traveled around the whole circuit together.
Oh, the 90s.
Yeah, the number 90. There you go.
I used to think you were cool because there was a clothing company called 90, and there used to have stickers that had number 90 on it. And I'm like, dude, this kid is coming out of the amateur ranks, and he already has stickers with his number on it. How cool is he?
Hey, what was that dealer's name that owned that? It was like, was it Staub?
I think
he was the guy that owned that.
I don't remember. How did you get hooked up with them?
From RL. Yeah, RL knew some skate guy and snow guy. Anyway. I guess that brand's back around again. They opened it up again.
Really?
Yeah.
It'll never be the same without you.
No, they got to have the big Airwalk box van repping it, or it's just not the same.
Yeah.
Well, hey, man, I wanted to pick your brain about Ivan Tedesco. We had him on the show today, and... I know you guys have been buddies since way back in the Plano Honda days, so I just wanted to get your thoughts on him. I mean, what drew you to him back when you guys hired him at Plano?
Well, when I went to Plano, I was at Triple X before that, and I got an opportunity to go work at Plano because Wyatt was there, Wyatt Seals, and he was working with Grayson Goodman, and he really didn't want to you know, work with a startup and all this stuff. And I just got done, you know, doing the Triple X thing. So he referred me to the owner, and I got it. And they already had Ivan on their radar. I really didn't know about Ivan. I kind of knew a little bit, you know, from the amateur scene. And the first time I ever met Ivan was at Steel City in 1999. And what happened was I went with the owner, a gentleman named Steve Wagner, who is, you know, he's a, you know, he was a Texas guy, you know, probably in his, you know, mid-40s, and proper, you know, tucked in shirt, the whole bit, looking all proper. And, you know, then you got me, you know, flat bill, black socks. And he's like, this is the guy that's running my show. What the hell? And so we're sitting there, and he's like, we're going to meet Ivan. I'm going to introduce you to Ivan, and we're going to talk some business. And I said, all right, cool. So he's like, he's in a camper. He's in a truck with a trailer with a camper. And I'm like, okay. So what he had was he had a pickup truck with that over, with the Lansing deal with the trailer on the top with the overhang, you know, like remember when you did look out in front of it? And he pulled in the pits with Ronnie Clark. And he's like, I go, is that him? He's like, yep, that's him driving. And dude, he looked like a little kid, dude, like behind the steering wheel. And he pulls in, and we pull up right next to him before he even gets out. And he opens the door to get out, and like five empty Coors Light cans fall out of the truck.
No way.
And right then, I go, oh yeah. I go, right then and there, I go, this is a cool kid. I like this kid. Even though last week in Millville, his debut, he got smoked, and he's supposed to be working his ass off during the week. I like that. Like, he's out having fun, blah, blah, blah. And the other guy didn't see it. And he's like, Ivan didn't know me. And he was like, oh, I'm like, dude, don't even worry about it. So from that day on, there was something special that we had that connection. But that was the first time I ever met Ivan. You know, we you know, got him on the bike, and it was good. Like, we were super, super anticipating big things out of him, but that first year it was just injury after injury for him, and he never even raced.
Yeah. What was it about him that you really liked? Like, how would you describe him to somebody?
You know what I liked about it? I remember, and you were there too. I think you raced against him at that Glen Helen Supercross.
Yeah.
And he was wearing shift gear. He was like, I think he was number 8 on a Yamaha 125. And dude, his stuff just looked so clapped out, and he was just he. I don't know if he won. I don't think he won. He might have won, but he did really well. And I just really liked his attitude. You know, we're getting into the era of Ricky Carmichael training and all that stuff, and he had that old school mentality of, you know, I ride dirt bikes; it's no big deal. And I really liked that. I really, really liked that about him at that time.
Yeah, I was always impressed by how humble he was. You know, like, even when he was winning championships back-to-back, it was like he was the same kid.
Always.
You know what I mean? Yeah.
Always. Even those first couple of years, he had what you can't teach somebody. He had raw speed, okay? He was a crasher, don't get me wrong. He would crash with the best of them, but he would haul ass.
Yeah,
but he back in the day though he didn't really know about technique and you know what to do. But we all know that he pretty much dedicated himself and turned himself into multi champion.
Yeah, no, his career we told him today, man, like he's had one of these sneaky careers that you look back and you go, wow, he won a lot of shit. Like, he really did good.
I mean, a lot of people don't really realize how good of a career he really had because it was so quiet and he wasn't that guy to pound his chest, and it was really before his social media. I mean, if he did what he did today back then, I mean, he went 3 donations, I think, two flex championships. And
yep. And, two TVD Supercross and a TVD Outdoor. I mean, that's legit.
Yeah, dude, that one race he had in Colorado was, dude, I don't think I've ever seen him more in tune with the bike and on point when he won that 450 race. I was like, that's what he needed. He's going to break through. and you know, it never happened for him. But you know, even when he went to the 450, when he left Stitches and he went to Suzuki, when he was teammates with Ricky, he had a great off season. He was riding really well until he went to Toronto. And there's a photo I should send it to you. I have. He got landed on by James and freaking just demolished his hand. And there's, I have a picture of him standing on the side of the track, flipping James Stewart off when he's with the medic.
Send it to me. We'll put it up right now in this interview.
It's classic. It's classic. Like, well, he's that type of guy.
We talked about that crash where he, second lap of practice, Stu just jumped on top of him and ruined his hand.
Yeah, that ruined him for the season. And that was the year that Chad and Ricky were going for it. And a lot of people don't remember, Chad called Ivan out on the podium. And, you know, Ivan was all pissed. And then another time, you know, going into the race, the final round, they were saying Ivan was blocking for Ricky. And I remember Ivan, dude, he got out of control. Like, we went out that night and we're drinking and have something. And I went my way, he went his way. And then he called me about an hour later. It's probably 3 a.m. And he's, you know, a good one. And he's like, where you at? Come with me. And I'm like, why? He's like, I'm going to kick Reed's ass. I'm going to find him. I want to beat his ass. I'm like, go to bed. He's like, you're either going with me or you're a pussy. So I go, all right, I'll be right there. And we were at MGM and we went down. And then, no, we were at the Hard Rock. And then we never found him. And then him and Paul Carpenter sat there and played blackjack and got foobarred, unbelievably drunk.
Oh, jeez. Him and Carpenter had a bad combination, I think.
Oh, dude.
Or the best combination. Paul Carpenter. I can't tell which one.
Dude, that year, I think, what was the year Paul Carpenter wrote for Kawasaki?
It was 04 or 05. He was talking about that. He stayed back there with him, and they were both on Cali's. I can't remember which year it was. Maybe 05.
I think.
Maybe 04.
Yeah, whatever year that was, I remember we were at Washougal. And the night before the race, a couple guys, none of the riders, it was like maybe a couple mechanics or whatever, we decided we were going to go to a strip club. And Carpenter found out, and he calls, and he goes, I'm going with you. And I'm like, dude, we're not going to be back until late. You need to race. He's like, dude, I don't care. Dude, he went, he got hammered to the point where I think he threw up, and the next day he podiumed.
No way. Didn't they call him, Carpenter, in the nickname of Little Dogger or something like that, didn't he?
I don't know what they called him.
Yeah, they were calling him something like that.
Dude, that guy, like, and it was crazy because Ivan would hang out with him all the time and just let Paul go do his thing, and Ivan would put the work in, you know? Yeah. And that's when Ivan was, like, you know, trying to get his shit together, you know, at the Yamaha Troy time. As soon as he got on to Mitch's, it was like, all right, this is my deal. Like, you know, it's time to go.
Yeah. Well, he's a hell of a dude. I appreciate the stories. I just love getting, like, a little backstories like that from guys that spend a lot of time around him, so... I appreciate it. We'd love to get you on the Whiskey Throttle Show yourself here one of these days.
I would love to do it. I got some stories that I've held back for a long time because I've always thought that, you know, people wouldn't dig them. But you know what? I got nothing to hide any longer. You know, so let's do it. Ain't no big deal to me. Congratulations to you and Grant. You guys are doing a good job.
I appreciate it, man. And you want to plug your? You got some podcast stuff you're doing?
I'm not plugging nothing yet. Not until we're up and going. But I got some stuff I'm working on, and I think everybody will enjoy it. And I hope we can make it to the level as the Whiskey Throttle.
Oh well, shoot. We'll get you on the show. We'll talk about it then.
Sounds good, my man.
All right, dude. Great catching up, K Dub. You take care. We'll talk soon.
All right, David. Talk to you later.
See you, buddy.
All right, and we're back. That was Kenny Watson. Always good to hear Kenny's voice. Good dude. Been around for a long time. And that's our show.
Cool.
That is our show, boys. Thanks for coming in. As always, check out PowerDot, PowerDot.com. 20% off. Type in the code WhiskeyThrottle. Method Race Wheels, Troy Lee Designs. Get in and check out all their 2020 stuff. Decal Works, Dunlop, Four Wheel Parts. Adidas, Pro Circuit, Nihilo Concepts, again, giving you 20% off. Get over there and check out their grip tape, their lever grip. They got all kinds of new products, especially if you're riding a KTM or Husky. Lots of stuff for them. Specialized, Racer X, Paleo Ranch, Langston Motorsports, Fire Department Coffee. Get over to firedeptcoffee.com. You get 20% off there using the code WhiskeyThrottle. Awesome, awesome company and product. And we will see you guys on our next show. Thanks for watching. I'm David Pingree for GL and Donnie. See you next time.